ராமானுஜதயாபாத்திரம் ஞானவைராக்ய பூஷணம் ஸ்ரீமத் வெங்கடநாதாரியம் வந்தே வேதாந்த தேசிகம் லக்ஷ்மீநாத சமாரம்பாம் நாதயா முனமத்யமாம் அஸ்மதாச்சாரிய பரியந்தாம் வந்தே குரு பரம்பராம் யோ நித்யம் அச்சுத பதாம்புஜ யுக்ம ருக்ம வியாமோஹதஸ்ததிதராணி த்ரிணாயமேனே அஸ்மத் குரோர் பகவதோஸ்ய தயைக சிந்தோ ராமானுஜஸ்ய சரணௌ சரணம் பிரபத்யே மாதா பிதா யுவதயஸ்தனயா விபூதிஸ் சர்வம் யதேவ நியமேன மதன்வயானாம் ஆத்யஸ்ய நஃ குலபதேர் வகுளாபிராமம் ஸ்ரீமத் ததங்க்ரி யுகளம் பிரணமாமி மூர்த்னா பூதம் சரஸ்ச மஹதாஹ்வய பட்டநாத ஸ்ரீபக்திசார குலசேகர யோகிவாஹான் பக்தாங்கிரி ரேணு பரகால யதீந்திரமிஸ்ரான் ஸ்ரீமத் பராங்குஷமுனிம் பிரணதோஸ்மி நித்யம். கூஜந்தம் ராம ராமேதி மதுரம் மதுராட்சரம் ஆருஹ்ய கவிதா சாகாம் வந்தே வால்மீகி கோகிலம் வால்மீகேர் முனி சிம்ஹஸ்ய கவிதா வனச்சாரிணஹ ஶ்ருண்வன் ராமகதா நாதம் கோனயாதி பராம் கதிம் வேதவேத்யே பதே பும்சி ஜாதே தசரதாத்மஜே வேத ப்ராசீத சதாசீத் சாக்ஷாத் ராமாயணாத்மனா அஞ்சனானந்தனம் வீரம் ஜானகீசோகநாசனம் கபீஷமக்ஷஹந்தாரம் வந்தே லங்கா பயங்கரம் மனோஜவம் மருததுல்யவேகம் ஜிதேந்திரியம் புத்திமதாம் வரிஷ்டம் வாதாத்மஜம் வானரயூதமுக்யம் ஸ்ரீராமதூதம் சிரசா நமாமி ஆஞ்சநேயமதிபாடலானனம் காஞ்சனாத்ரிகமனீயவிக்ரஹம் பாரிஜாததருமூலவாசினம் பாவயாமி பவமானநந்தனம் யத்ர யத்ர ரகுநாதகீர்த்தனம் தத்ர தத்ர க்ருதமஸ்தகாஞ்சலிம் பாஷ்பவாரி பரிபூர்ணலோசனம் மாருதிம் நமத ராட்சசாந்தகம். A very good evening to the gathering here. As cited at the commencement of the lecture, we will have 8 lectures on Srimad Ramayanam this year and 8 lectures the following year. In the set of 8 lectures that have been scheduled for this year, the first 3 that relate to Bala Kandam is being presented now. 3 on Ayodhya Kandam in the month of June, 2 on Aranya Kandam in the month of November. And of the 3 lectures that speak on Bala Kandam, we have got 2 lectures completed. The first day dealt with how Valmiki, the Rishi of Bhrugukulam, then who was brought up as a hunter, who later turned into a dacoit, under the guidance of Sapta Rishis, with Ramanama Japam became Valmiki, the Maharishi, and later how his doubts initially were cleared by Narada Maharishi, followed by the incident of the hunter shooting at the male bird and the female bird lamenting over the death, and then him uttering a curse which was later understood to be a blessing, and this doubt being cleared by none other than Brahma himself, the wives of Brahma, namely Saraswati and Savitri, blessing Valmiki that his scripture, his composition will attain the holiness by their very presence at the tip of the pen in which he writes. Followed by this, we had him, that is Valmiki Maharishi, engaging Sita, the queen of Ayodhya, for her delivery in his ashramam. On the other side, with the blessing of Brahma, he could start writing Srimad Ramayanam. And yesterday in Srimad Ramayanam, we got to witness how he described the beautiful province called Koshala with its capital Rajadhani called as Ayodhya, and the flora and the fauna and the prosperity of Ayodhya too. This was followed by how Dasharatha, initially as a father of a daughter called Shanta, gave her in adoption to a king called Romapada of Angadesha, who later got her married to a great sage called Rishyashringa, the son of Vibhandaka and the grandson of sage Kashyapa. Shanta and Rishyashringa were invited again back to Ayodhya under the guidance of Romapada to bless Dasharatha having sons. So he performed the great yajnam called as Ashwamedham. Ashwamedham was performed for 1 year, followed by the supplementary yagam called as Putrakama Ishti, which had three smaller parts of yajnam in it. Now here I forgot to mention one important information. Here Valmiki says Ashwamedha Yajnena Pura. In Sanskritam, Pura, the word, denotes something in the eternal past, the past that one can never trace to. So here Valmiki says, the Ashwamedham, he Dasharatha, was performed in the past by Swayambhu. Swayambhu means Brahma. So Swayambhu has performed Ashwamedham. This is what Ramayanam tells. Beyond that, Sumantra continues the general description. But we need to understand where this Ashwamedham was performed. We know that Ashwamedham was performed by Brahma sometime in the past. This is what Valmiki tells. He doesn't go one step further. But where was it performed? See, Brahma wanted to perform 1,000 Ashwamedha Yajnams. To perform one itself is an arduous task. And to perform any yajnam, the presence of one's wife is very, very pertinent and important. Without the presence of one's wife, the man cannot perform the yajnam, tells Shastram. Anashrami ekadinam na bhavet. Even for 1 day, a person should not be without an ashrama. It is for that reason, on the first day, I cited that Bhishmacharya, though he is known to the world as a brahmachari, he followed brahmacharyam, but he was a grihastha. He was not a brahmachari. Please remember this. We know that Mukesh Khanna was a brahmachari, but the director did not take pains to learn Mahabharatam in detail. This is all I can say. Because in Sri Mahabharatam, Bhishma was called as Devavrata in his previous form, even before he could obtain this new name. Devavrata goes to the Swargalokam to understand how to use missiles from Brihaspati, from Parashurama and many other people. When he comes back, his father Shantanu accepts him as his very own son. One day, Devavrata finds that his father is very upset. So, in many of the houses, whatever is happening in the house, the driver will know much better. So this Devavrata went and inquired his father's charioteer. He asked, why is my father upset? He said, last week your father went on a boat ride. The boat was ridden by a lady called as Satyavati. She is called as Matsyagandhi because she was given a boon by Parashara Maharishi that she will have a fragrant smell and that smell can be smelt even 6 miles away. So this Satyavati called Matsyagandhi was the one who rode Shantanu from one bank of Ganga to the other. Whether he liked the ride or not, he liked the person who rode the boat. So he went and immediately confided in her that I like you. She said, talk to my father. At least she had that courtesy. So that king, Shantanu, went and spoke to Satyavati's father. Satyavati's father said, you already have a son, a great warrior son called as Devavrata. I'm sure very soon he will get married. If he gets married, he will be made the higher apparent. Slowly he will become the king. And if he gets married, he will have a son. That son will become the king. So eventually that son and his legacy will continue as the one that becomes an aristocrat, whereas my daughter and her children may not have the right to do so. Understanding this, Shantanu did not speak a word and he came back unhappy. Understanding this, Devavrata goes back to the hermitage of that the chief of the fisher folk, Satyavati's father. He tells, from today onwards, I will be a brahmachari. This is the shlokam in Mahabharatam. From today, adhyame, from today onwards, I will be a brahmachari. We say, this January 1st, from today onwards, I will do. That means, the contrary would have happened till then. if you are already doing one particular, if you have a certain habit, you will never say from today onwards I will recite shlokas. It means the corollary is I have not been reciting till now. So he says from today onwards I will be a brahmachari. This is point one. In algebra, this is called simultaneous equations. Keep this as equation one. Now, what could have happened? In those days, after one undergoes Vedic education, there is a process called as samavartanam. Samavartanam is a stage where the boy, after having graduated from the Vedic school, is given the ceremonial bath with turmeric water. So after the bath is over, the boy who was then wearing the brahmachari attire is now entitled to wear the panchakacham of a grihastha. His three threads will become six in number just after the ceremony. Now, after the ceremony is over, within a few days, he has to take up to one of the ashramams. One is a grihastha. Second is a sannyasi. He has no other option. He has to take one of the two. If Devavrata had taken up to sannyasam, the rule says that a sannyasi can neither cook nor fight. Sannyasi should not cook by himself. He should go seeking alms. And whatever alms he seeks, it should be cooked rice. Whereas a grihastha will get uncooked rice. Brahmachari should get cooked rice. It should be annam. So, one, he cannot cook. Second, a sannyasi cannot fight. Bhishmacharya fought and taught people how to fought. To fight. So in that case, he could have never been a sannyasi. So he must have been a grihastha. How do we understand this? Now we have to go to equation 2. Only a grihastha is allowed to perform three types of yagam in a day. It is called tretagni. Morning you perform one, afternoon you perform two, night you perform three. It is called garhapatyam, vaishvanaram, Dakshinagni. These are all the three kinds of Agni karyams that a grihastha should perform in those days. So that fire should keep burning in your house. And from that fire only, the person who has been performing all this while in his life, after his death happens, his last rites should be done using that fire, not with that cheetah matchbox. It should happen with this fire. So this is called Tretagni Kalpanam. Imagine that a grihastha is becoming a sannyasi. I'm sure a lot of you will know the acharyas of Ahobilamat. The current acharya is a Rigvedi. He was a Nitya Agnihotri. When he decides to become a sannyasi, that day he should bid farewell to that fire and come. So that is one process. So after the death of that person, whoever has been performing Agnihotram, who's called Agnihotri, that fire is used to burn. And who can perform the Treta Agni? Only a grihastha can perform. Brahmachari is not allowed to perform. A sannyasi cannot do Agni Karyam. So upon the death of Bhishmacharya, Krishna tells Yudhishthira, go do the Treta Agni Kalpanam of the fire which Bhishma has been doing till now and get that fire and perform. So Ramanujacharya, using these two equations, concludes that Bhishma was a grihastha. So in Brahma Sutram, there is a sutram called as Antarachapitu Tadrishtehe. In that sutram, Ramanujacharya in Sri Bhashyam states, Raikva Bhishma Samvartadinam Anashraminam Brahma Vidya Nishtatvam. So he says that one cannot be a Anashrami. Without an ashramam, one cannot be there. Sir, why did you tell all this? Because Brahma had to perform 1000 Ashwamedha Yajnams. He needed a wife. But his wife is a very famous Veena player. So she has got concerts throughout the year, Saraswati Devi. So she said, I cannot cooperate with you throughout the year for 1000 Yajnams. So he started analyzing, is there one place where if I do Yajnam once, it will be equal to 1000 Yajnams? You might have heard such punch dialogues in movies. If I tell once, it is equivalent to 100 times. So likewise, here if I do once, it should be equivalent to 1000 times.
there is one kshetram called as Satyavrata Kshetram, which is called Kanchipuram. Kanchipuram is called Satyavratam. If you even go to Kanchi Acharyas, the current Pithadipatis, they will recite the titles of that Acharyas. They will say Satyavrata Kshetra Parivrajaka Acharyanam. You will be wondering what is Satyavrata Kshetram, Kanchipuram. In Satyavrata Kshetram, if you perform any yajnam once, it is equivalent to 1,000. So, Brahma chose a hill called as Hastigiri and performed that yagam once. Ashwamedham Pura, Valmiki tells, right, once he performed. He performed that in Kanchipuram. So, that is why Vedanta Deshika tells, Dvirada Shikhari Simna Sadbhavan Padmayonehe Turagasavana Vedyam Shyamalo Havyavahaha. Havyavahaha means fire. Kalashajaladhikanya Vallari Kalpashakhi Kalayatu Kushalamnaha Kobikarunya Rashihi. Appaya Dikshita, one of the greatest scholars Advaita has seen, tells in Varadarajastavam that even if you go today to the sanctum sanctorum of Varadaraja, you can smell the Ashwamedha Yajnam's prodosham. Prodosham is a ball that is put in that Ashwamedham. He says you can still smell that. So this is to conclude that you need to bring the Kshetra Mahatmyam and Ramayanam together. Nevertheless, he performed Ashwamedham, and after performing Ashwamedham, he performed Putra Kameshti. During the Ashwamedham, a person rose, Yajna Purusha arose from the Yajna Kundam. Krishnam Raktam Baradharam Raktasyam Dundubhiswanam Snigdha Haryakshanujushyamam Ashrupurvardhamurdhajam Shubhalakshana Sampannam Divya Bharana Bhushitam Shaila Shringam Samutsedyam Drupta Shardula Vikramam. So he arose with a payasam, a golden pot with a silver lid. The payasam was distributed as 50% to Kaushalya, 25% to Sumitra, 12.5% to Kaikeyi, the remaining 12.5% again to Sumitra. Anuchintya Sumitrayai Punareva Mahamatihi. Thus, after 12 months, the children were born after the gestation of 12 months. Tatascha Dvadashe Mase Chaitre Navamike Tithau Nakshatre Aditi Devatye Swachha Samstheshu Panchasu Graheshu Karkate Lagne Vakpatad Indunasaha Prodhyamane Jagannatham Sarvaloka Namaskritam Kausalya Janayadramam Divya Lakshana Sayutam. When Kausalya gave birth to Rama, it was as if he was born with all the royal insignia in him, followed by the birth of Bharata. Bharato Nama Kaikeyam Jagnye Satyaparakramaha Sakshad Vishnus Chaturbhagaha Sarvaihi Samudito Gunaihi. Then Lakshmana and Shatrughna were born in the nakshatram that denotes the snake. It is called Aslesha, or in Tamil it is called as Ayilyam. Atha Lakshmana Shatrughna Sumitra Janayat Sutau Virau. You are able to understand the words Virau. In Sanskritam, there is something called Dvivachanam. So Dvivachanam will always have Aukarantam. Ramau, Krishnau. This is very important, because after 1 hour I will be dealing with the Dvivachanam very importantly. So here he says, Virau Sarvastra Kushalau Vishnor Ardha Samanvitau. They were born as the Amsham of Vishnu. Now, Rama was given the name Rama because Ramante Sarve Janaha Gunaihi Asmin Iti Ramaha. Since he impresses everyone by his qualities as well as looks. Beauty with brains is a rarity, but it was very common in the days of Ramayanam, because Sita was also like that, so was Rama. So Rama was born, and on the contrary, we had Bharata, who was to serve Rama. His bhakti called as Bhagavat Paratantryam, followed by Lakshmana, whose bhakti is called as Bhagavat Seshatvam, followed by Shatrughna, which is Bhagavata Seshatvam. So they were all born, and they all grew up since their childhood with the best of fraternity in them. Balyat Prabhriti Susnigdaha. So they were all attached like that from childhood, and they grew up. Once the king was worried. What was the age? The age was 12. For whom? Rama. What will be the age for Bharata? 12. What will be the age of Lakshmana Shatrughna? 12. I always had this doubt whenever I look at a Rama Pattabhishekam photo. Rama will be 8 feet and quite well built.
6 feet will be Bharata and Lakshmana Shatrughna will be 4 feet. I don't know who has given the artist this kind of an imagination. They were all looking very similar. They say in Ramayanam that Rama and Bharata were the same complexioned. They looked the same. Lakshmana and Shatrughna looked the same. So Lakshmana always attached himself to Rama. Shatrughna always attached himself to Bharata. So initially, crossing the Ganges, it was Rama who came with Lakshmana. After having been hospitable to the duo, now from Shringi Bhairapuram, Guha sees Bharata coming with Shatrughna. He thinks it is a deja vu. Because just now he has seen one couple like that. He sees the another now. Nambiyum yennayaganai okkindran, ayal nindran thambiyayum okkindran, thavavedam thanai nindran, thunbam oru mudivillai ena disai nokki tholugindran, emberuman pinpirandar ilaipparo pilaippu endran, tells Kambar. So both of them were looking very similar. Another myth buster. We all have heard that Lakshmana has never slept in the 14 years, correct? Is it biologically possible? Imagine, if you don't sleep for 3 days also, then you will come to the conclusion that the Ramayana lectures have to get extended. So, sleep is required either for 1 hour or 2 hours. Imagine one person not sleeping for 365 days for 14 years. This is not possible. Why do people say that? As Indians, we believe bhakti is possible only through exaggeration. Only if this is exaggerated, we think bhakti is. We also come to a conclusion that the number of photos in the house of the deities is directly proportional to the bhakti that we have. So the photos keep on perennially increasing, which is not so. Even without a photo, your bhakti can exist. Imagine 200 years before, when there were not so many printing presses, how did people live? Do you think they were all drawing portraits of Rama, Lakshmana and every deity that they saw? They might have had Shalagramam at their house. They might have been a Shiva Bhakta, they might have had a Linga or a Rudraksham in their house. That's all. Presence of Bhagavatas is what that adds holiness to a house and not the number of photos. Anywhere you turn around, you will see many photos. And today, bhakti has progressed to such an extent. At the end of every such lecture, in generally, one person will be standing outside with so many Rama photos. They'll keep distributing one after one. So as a trust, we decided initially, though upon the insistence of so many Bhagavatas, we have placed the photo of Rama, we have not been placing for the very fact that bhakti has to be conceived mentally first, and then it can come through portraits. Minimally it should be done. Portraits in invitations, paintings throughout the house, and then having saris with Ramayanam in the border, in the pallu. Is this what we try to say, that we are trying to help the culture? No way. Culture has no relation to it at all. What conceives in the mind and then dawns upon as wisdom is what is more important, rather than multiplying the photos. And I'm sure those of you who do that are doing it with a good cause. But please think twice before you do that, whether your children will carry forward these portraits or not. If they will not carry forward the portraits, then where will all the portraits go to? It will either go to some pitiable temple in the vicinity, or it will end up in the paper wala's dukan. Both of which we don't want it to happen. So now coming back to the topic, here we had Rama. What was his age? We need to decide. For deciding his age, we have to first understand what was king's worry. He says, Atharaja Dasharatham Tesham Dharakriyam Prati Chintayamasa Dharmatma Sopadhyayaha Sabandavaha. The king got into a big round table conference. He was discussing. What was he discussing? That my son has come of age and he is not yet married. Now we have to understand at what age he was worrying. For that, we have to come to a conclusion. What was Rama's age then? For that, I am coming up with 4 equations which you will all appreciate, because everybody feels, sir, lectures have to be rational, sir, then only we will attend. Why should we believe what you say? You are very right. You don't have to believe what I say. You can believe what Valmiki says. Valmiki doesn't directly tell what was the age of Rama or Sita. First equation, Ashtadashahi Varshani Mama Janmani Ganyate Bharta Mama Mahateja Vayasa Pamcha Vimshakaha. This is the shlokam which comes in Aranyakandam, where Sita tells Ravana, who's come in the disguise of some sannyasi. So the sannyasi asks, Sita, you tell me about your past. It is very important that she should have done some identity card check. She didn't do. She immediately started telling what all jewelry her father presented, what he is yet to present. So all this she gave the list. That time she tells, Ashtadashahi Varshani. Ashtadasha. Ashtadasha. I was 18 years of age. Mama Janmani Ganyate. People who count my age tell that I was at 18 years of age. Bharta Mama Mahateja. Bharta, my husband. Mama, my husband. Mahateja, the one with great resplendence. Vayasa Pancha Vimshakaha. When we started to the forest, he was 25. And I was 18. Now, this is equation 1. Keep X as the age of Rama and Y as the age of Sita. Now, you have to form an equation with this. So, X is temporarily 18. Y is temporarily 25. Next. Samadvadasha tatraham raghavasya niveshane. Here, this Sita tells to Hanuman. She tells, Samadvadasha tatraham. Hanuman, after marriage, Rama and me lived happily in Ayodhya for 12 years. That means, if X is the age of Sita and Y is the age of Rama, both X and Y lived for 12 years after their marriage. So, you need to derive another variable called X1 and Y1. That X1 and Y1 will be the age of Rama and Sita during marriage. X and Y are after the 12 years. This is equation 2. Equation 3. Balo dvadasha varshoyam akritas tatracha ragavaha. Maricha will now be driven away by Rama during the yajna samrakshanam. Maricha goes and falls in the south of India. Ravana travels all the way from Sri Lanka to the south of India to approach his own uncle. Maricha was the own uncle of Ravana. He tells, you need to go and lure Sita in the form of a deer. That time, Maricha tells, when Rama was at the age of 12, he drove me here. Now he will be of a bigger age and he will be the husband of Sita. Can I even handle that great warrior? So he tells, Balo Dvadasha Varshoyam. While he was 12 years of age, he sent me here. This is the third equation. So we have to understand this equation where Y is 12. X is Sita, right? Sir, I think you have to continue with the story. Now, let us go finally to the last equation. From this, we understand that Rama was at the age of 12. 12 years, Sita and Rama lived happily, which makes him 24. And while he turned 25 and Sita was 18, they came to the forest. That means Sita must have been 18 minus 12, which is 6 during marriage. Correct? This is the third. But there is one contradicting equation in Ramayanam. I'll tell you. There, Kaushalya tells Rama, Dasha saptacha varishani tava jatasya putraka asitani prakankshantya maya dukha parikshatam. She tells, Rama comes and tells Kaushalya, Mate, my father has commanded me that I have to go to the forest for 14 years. Kaushalya initially resists. She tells, have I been waiting for 17 years like this since your birth for you to go to the forest? Now imagine, Rama was married at the age of 12. They lived in happily in Ayodhya for number of years. How many years? 12. So Rama would have been 24 and starting 25. At that age, he goes and falls at the feet of his mother. But the mother is telling, for 17 years I have been waiting for this opportunity since your birth. Then she is wrong. Correct? She could be wrong. But she is not wrong. She is Rama's mother. How can she go wrong? Because I told you yesterday, Dvijaha means one who is born twice from the mother's womb. And second, when his sacred threat ceremony happens, that is called the second birth. So if 7 years was the age when threat ceremony happened for Rama, you should count 7 plus 17, which will be 25. You are getting to the conclusion now. Now, let's get back to where we had left. So Dasharatha was worried that his son was not married. So what was Rama's age now? 12. Now Vishwamitra enters. When Vishwamitra entered the court, they all trembled. As I told you, Vishwamitra was a very controversial person. He will always court controversy. So immediately they all stood up and they welcomed him. And he said, Dasharatha, I am very happy to reach your court. Please help me and I need your help very badly. Dasharatha said, I promise, sir, that I will help you. Right Honorable V.S. Srinivasa Shastri concludes, King Dasharatha seems to have had a fatal defect of promising in haste and repenting in leisure, he tells. Because he will not even understand what the situation is. He will say, I will promise. Then he will repent why I have promised. This is the same case with Dasharatha throughout Ramayanam. So he tells Vishwamitra, I promise, whatever you ask, I will give. That is when Vishwamitra tells, Aham Vedmi Mahatmanam Ramam Satya Parakramam Dasharatha, I know very well that your son Rama is very, very strong. But Dasharatha was wondering, why are you bringing Ram into the picture? Wait for me to complete my speech. Tells Vishwamitra, he tells, you are a Dharma Kamaishti, you are a person who desires wealth, whereas I am a Moksha Kamaishti. You desire artham, whereas I desire moksham. You have something called as a scepter in your hand, whereas I have got something called as a bunch of darbha grass in my hand. So I can understand what is the importance of your son. Aham vedmi. People like you who enjoy the comforts. Kottikkal, kattil mel, mettendra, pancha shayanathin meleri. You may be the one who sleeps on the mattress that sits atop a bed that is made up of the ivory of an elephant. And you may be enjoying all the comforts in your life. Not me so. I may not be enjoying. I will be sleeping on the rugged floor in the forest. And I take up all the difficulties. I know how hard it is to even reach the harem of Rama and how important he is as a personality. So I know the importance of your son. Aham vedmi mahatmanam. Dasharatha still did not realize. What do you want? Swaputram rajashardula ramam satyaparakramam kakapaksha dharam veeram jeshtam me datumarhasi. Give me the son of yours. When he walks, the curly hair locks should come near his temples. That kind of a dark complexion. Very strong, yet humble, grounded, strong son of yours, Rama, should be given. Jeshtam me datumarhasi, he tells. Alvar describes this in Thirunedun Thandagam. To those of you who are not introduced to the language of Tamil, you will all be amazed to know that a set of 4,000 verses in chaste Tamil is called as Nalaira Divya Prabandham. This was written much in the first millennium and even 1,000 years before the first millennium during the Sangam era. So one of the earliest literature that we can trace to. Amongst those mystic saints who sang praises of the Lord in various abodes of the Lord, the last of the saints was called as Thirumangai Alvar. He has composed 6 works. Periya Thirumuli, Thirunedun Thandagam, Thirukkurun Thandagam, Siriya Thirumadal, Periya Thirumadal, Thiruvezhukkuthirukkai. Those of you who find a lot of demonstrations happening in Tamil Nadu to protect the Tamil language, you go ask one of the protesters to even recite these names. Thiruvezhukkuthirukkai. He will leave his biryani parcel that he has been offered for the march and will go back home. So in those 6 prabandhams, the last of it is called Thirunedun Thandagam. Alvar tells, Maivannan Narunkunji Kudalpin Thaala Magaram Sher Kulai Irubad Irangiyada Eivannan Shilaya Iruvarai Vandar Yenmunne Nindrar Kaivannam Tamaraivai Kamalam Polum Aravindamum Kandum Tori Avarainam Devarendru Anjinome Maivannan Narunkunji Kudalpin Thaala. Alvar tells that when Rama walks, it seems some of his hair locks dances in front while some at the back. The best example that I can get closest to you as a visual treat is the shampoo advertisements that you see. When they do it, you will find Maivannan Narunkunji Kulalpin Thaala. So whenever you see a shampoo advertisement, you should be reminded of Thirumangai Alvar. Whenever you see the hair clip in the market, you should be reminded of Gajendra Moksham. Because the crocodile caught the foot of the elephant that way. So every object should remind you of this. It should not be the contrary. When you think of Gajendra Moksham, you should not think of the hair clip. When you think of the hair, see the hair clip, you should think of Gajendra Moksha. Here, we had Kakapaksha Dharam Veeram Jeshtam Me Datumarhasi. Give me your eldest son. That is when Dasharatha swooned. But Vishwamitra was unrelenting and unyielding. He said, I will not leave this place without Rama. But then Dasharatha stood. Una shodasha varshome Ramo Rajiva Lochanaha Nayuddha Yogya Tamyasya Pashyami Saharakshasaihi. I cannot send my son who is not even 16 years of age, where 16 years is mentioned as the minimum age to even wage a battle. My son, Me Ramaha Rajiva Lochanaha. The first reason why I cited the word Me Ramaha yesterday, if you remember, if Mamakaram is attached to an object that is given in alms, then that person who accepts it cannot accept. That is why in Yajnam we say Idanna Mama Na Mama. Na Mama means not mine. Na Mama put together is called Namaha. If you have heard of this word Namaha, Namaha comes from the word Na Mama. Not mine. From Namaha comes the mudra called Namaskaram. What is Namaskaram? Namaskaram says that I have to tell the opposite person, sir, this Atma, what I am claiming to be mine, does not belong to me. It belongs to the Lord. Na Mama. So don't ever worry, if I stand in front of you, don't think that I am talking. It is the Lord who's making me talk. So, namama, namama. So, you do namaskaram. Manasa, vacha, karmaneva. All the three should come to equilibrium. All the three. What is it? Manasa, vacha, karmana. Any action where three things come together, that action will be very successful, tells Vedanta Deshika. Any action should have the person's mind in it. Namama, I get inside a flight. The air hostess who is supposed to serve me has been trained in her company that she has to tell namaskar. But is she doing with the habit of telling namama? No, this man is coming to trouble me.
Namaskar.
So, manasa is not there. Vacha. Second, some people will say. It should come out of the mouth also. Vacha. Third, karmana. Some people will say, namaskar. No. The karmana should also be there. So, manasa, vacha, karmana. If a person studies during his school days this way, don't you think the subjects will be understood well? Manasa, the person should relish the subject. Vacha, he should open loudly and recite. Third, karmana, he should write whatever he reads. So, writing whatever he reads. Speaking whatever he reads. Internalizing whatever he reads. Manasa, vacha, karmana, all three put together will stay in the person's mind forever. Suppose we say that I don't like the subject and do, then that will not be of any use in the life at all. It will become a dead investment. So any subject that way has to come through three things together. Namama. So he tells, this is not mine. But Dasharatha uses this as a cue and tells, Me Ramaha, my Rama. If I tell my Rama, then Vishwamitra cannot accept. That is the first reason. Second reason is, the earlier Rama known to this world was Parashurama. Parashurama was a person who didn't need any reason at all to fight. He will come fighting for no reason. So, Dasharatha tells Vishwamitra, just because I have called my son Rama, you are thinking he's Parashurama. That is J Parashurama. Jamadagni Parashurama. This is D Rama, Dasharatha Rama. He doesn't know how to fight. Me Ramaha Rajiva Lochanaha Na Yuddha Yogya Tamyasya Pashyami Saharakshasaihi. You are calling him to fight against the demons who do not know how to adhere to the rules of fighting at all. This is the verse cited by Dasharatha to Vishwamitra. Vishwamitra tells, Mithya Pratigya Kakutstha Sukhi Bhava Suhridvitaha. From today onwards, you will be known as Dasharatha, the king who is known to make only false promises, Jhumla. So, you are giving only Jhumlas. So, people will know you only through this name. At this point in time, Mithya Pratigya Kakutstha Sukhi Bhava Suhridvitaha. May you live happily with your family. That is when, while he was leaving, Vasishtha stands up and tells Dasharatha,
Dasharatha, do you think that Vishwamitra cannot vanquish those demons in the battle? He can very well do that. Why is he not doing? The primary reason is, while doing a yajnam, he cannot harm or annihilate another person. Second, to add glory to your son. Dasharatha, you tell me, you have a very obedient son. But will any father be happy to give his daughter to your son? No accomplishment till date. See, in Krishnavataram, why did he get married to his mother's brother? Yashoda's brother was called Kumbha. Kumbha's daughter was called Neela. Neela in Tamil is called Pinnai. Since she was a good Pinnai, she is called Nappinnai. So Nappinnai is the Tamil word for Neela. Nishamayatu mam Neela. Yadbhoga patalai dhruvam bhavitam srinivasasya bhaktadosheswa darshanam. This is the verse cited by Vedanta Deshika in his beautiful 10 metered 100 versed poem called as Daya Shatakam. There he tells about Neela Devi. Incidentally, a lot of people have questions about Radha, Radhika in Krishna's life. Whenever God gives us way, we can listen to Bhagavatam one day. As per Bhagavatam, there is no personality called Radha or Radhika at all. This name comes in Padma Puranam, later it comes in Ashtapadi, and later it came in the other verses. In Devi Bhagavatam, there is a line, Radhanoti Sakalan Kaman Radheti Prakirtita. Radha was 6 years elder to Krishna. When Krishna was born, and his naming ceremony was done, Radha, who was the daughter of Vrishabhanu, visits Krishna. 6 years elder to Krishna. So you cannot blame Anjali Tendulkar always. There are cases like this everywhere. So here, we had Radha coming there. But here, in the case of Neela or Radhika, here we have Sita. Sita, in Krishna avataram, Krishna had many accomplishments. That is why he got married very early. He lifted Govardhanam. He could retrieve the cows and the calves from Brahma. He could vanquish the arrogance of Indra. He could kill demons who were antisocial elements like Putana, Keshi, Trinavarta, Pralambha, Kapitha, Agha, Dhenuka, and so on. He could pull the ego of a virulent poison-holding snake called as Kaliya. He could do Venuganam. He did Rasakrida all by the age of 12. So every mother was vigilant to get her daughter married to Krishna. But imagine in Rama's life, we don't have that. He did not have any accomplishments at all. And the biggest accomplishment which Rama felt was an accomplishment was he was obedient to his parents. But to the girl's side, it was not an accomplishment. So they thought they needed a son-in-law who was really accomplished. So Vasishtha tells Dasharatha, you send your son along with Vishwamitra, he will gain a lot of glory from now on. So Rama's CV was practically empty. So to get that CV filled immediately, he left with Vishwamitra. Now, initially while Dasharatha resisted, upon the instructions of the family priest Vasishtha, he agreed. He tells, Rama, come here. And Kulashekhar Alvar describes the way in which Dasharatha used to call Rama. He says, Va, pogu, va, va. He says, come. Ba, Kannadadalli helidre, ba anta helutivi. Adre Telugulo, Em Chaptaru, Rara Ikada. Anga Va. So Ra Ba Va. Some commonality, Akar Antham is there, except for the difference in Ra A Ba. That's all. So he said Va, come. And Rama would come. Pogu, go. And Rama would go. He would again say Va. Imagine doing this to your children. In your house, you say, Varsha, Ba Maili. You know. She will ask, La hogu. Yakari. She'll go. Ba. You nimjote. So she will have her own way of lamenting, right? But Rama used to be so obedient that his father used to say, come, go, come. Why? The commentator tells, when Rama used to walk in the front, the father used to have a glimpse of the frontal beauty.
And when Rama used to walk back, he used to have a relishment of the back beauty, because the saints have unanimously said that the Lord possesses two qualities. One is called Saundaryam. The second is called Lavanyam. Saundaryam means Avayava Shobha. Generally, if you go to Google and you type Saundaryam meaning, it will say beauty. You type Lavanyam, Lavanyam meaning beauty. But in Sanskritam, Saundaryam and Lavanyam don't denote the same beauty. Saundaryam means Avayava Shobha. If individually, part-wise, the man or the woman is handsome or beautiful, it is called Saundaryam. Overall, if they are good, it is called Lavanyam. So, if somebody says, how was the boy? Nose was beautiful. That means nose alone is beautiful. So, that is called Saundaryam. If you ask, how was the girl today? Overall, she looked good. Then it is Lavanyam. Some people even go to the extent of telling, from very far off, that person was very good. So, they caution you to not go very close. So, Saundaryam and Lavanyam, though they denote beauty, one is an individual beauty, Lavanyam is overall beauty. The Lord possessed both these qualities. Muthuswami Dikshitar, one amongst the Carnatic Trinity states, Saundarya Rajam Bhajeham Gajabrin Davana Saranga Rajam Nanda Nandana Rajam Nagapattina Rajam. Nagapattina Rajam. There's a beautiful city called Nagapattinam, and in that Nagapattinam, one of the earliest ports in the Chola era. So in that beautiful town called as Nagapattinam, you will find an abode of the Lord called as Saundarya Rajam. Very, very beautiful to look at. When you go to the temple, you will never feel like coming back. The mystic poet Thirumangayalvar tells, Ponnivarmeni Maradagathin Pongilam Shodi Anita Againindra Nal Vedir Vanavar Avartori Nalgulum Noki Anjigindrain Acho Uruvar Aragiyava. I have never seen beauty in this commensurate form ever in my life, tells the mystic saint. So he has Saundaryam, so he is called Saundarya Raja. Where does he have Lavanyam? Saint Tyagaraja tells, Lavanya Ramarala Rajudare Ati Lavanya Ramara. So Dasharatha could witness Saundaryam and Lavanyam in one person at one go. So he called Rama, Ramedi Madhuram Vanim. Even when he called the name Rama, it seems it used to be so beautiful. Rama, Rameti Madhuram Vanim tells Valmiki. So when Rama came, Lakshmana will come as a bonus offer. No, on Yugadi you get, right, 1+1 offer. Horlicks bottle, 200 rupees, you will get 1 rupee worth pen. But many people will buy the Horlicks bottle for the pen, to get that pen. You might have seen a lot of ads in the regional television channels where they sell plots. They will say, this plot is very close to the city. But if you go there, it will take you 2 hours to go inside the city. Inside the city itself, it takes 2 hours. To reach that place from outskirts, it will take. So that person will advertise very well. He say, if you buy this plot, you will get 1 gram gold. So for that 1 gram gold, they'll buy the plot. So likewise, for Rama, the free offer was Lakshmana. But the free offer was more valuable than Rama himself. Lakshmana was so much devoted, and without Lakshmana you cannot even have Ramayana proceeding. He's such a powerful character. Nevertheless, Dasharatha said, call Rama. Rama was 12 years of age. He made his son sit on the lap. Rama was 12 years. He made Rama sit on his lap, kissed on his forehead. Sir, is it there in Ramayana? Yes. Murdhani. On his forehead he kissed. Because as per Shastram, when the son or the daughter plays outside and comes home, the father should make the child sit on the lap and recite one mantra. Sir, we can make them sit on the lap. This mantra part is only tough. What is that mantra? Angad angad sambhavasi hridayat adhijayase atma vai putra namasi. So angad, angad sambhavasi. The father should tell the daughter or the son, look at your hands and my hands, they look quite similar. Angad, angad sambhavasi. Hridayat adhijayase. My wavelength and your wavelength is the same. Atmavai putranamasi. It feels as if my atma is born again in you. What is the meaning of atma? Don't tell me soul. Everybody in Facebook, if somebody dies, they'll say rest in peace. What will rest in peace? Tell me, what is going to rest in peace? Nothing will rest in peace. Body is going to be burnt or buried. Atma would have either gone to Vaikuntham or it will take another birth. By the time the person dies in Indiranagar, he will be born in Rajajinagar. So, that Atma will not know Purva Janmam, who is my father and who is my mother. In that case, we will be going to our previous Janma's house and standing outside that you did not do property distribution well. So, we don't know to this Janma itself. So, we should get logical about even lamenting over one's death. First of all, in Hinduism, in Sanatana Dharma, beyond a certain age, if a person dies, you should not even cry. That is what Shastram tells. That is why we keep listening. Of course, if young children die, if they all die at a very young age, then parents naturally, they will have that vatsalyam. If a person is dying at 85 years, then the wife keeps crying, you could have lived for some more time, then the person will be getting more pension than the salary. So, it is best that the Atma reaches a better place. You want to stay in this mundane world where there is so much of traffic and so many other problems, health issues. Why do we want to force the Atma to stay in this Shariram? Beyond a certain age, the Atma should voluntarily desire for moksham. That is called spiritual enlightenment. And second thing, when one dies or you want to convey the message, convey it very intelligently. You should tell, I am very happy that the Atma has left the mortal body and is traveling in the path of light. It is called Archiradi Margam. See, we have got a path called as a northern path and a southern path. The northern path is called the path of light. It is called Archis. Archis means fire. Fire gives light. So it is called the path of light. The other path, the southern path is called Dhumadi Margam. Dhumadi Margam means the path of smoke. If the Atma travels by the path of smoke, then the Atma has 100% chances to be born again. Whereas if the Atma traces the path of light, the Atma will never come back to this world. But why are we telling the other person that we are very happy that the Atma has traveled by the path of light? Did we see? No. Probability states 1 by 2 he could have traveled by light. So let us think positively and that person is not being born again. That's all we can do. So rest in peace. I'm very sorry to note that. Rest in peace. What is going to rest in peace? Nothing will rest in peace. So only we have to be peaceful after that person's death. So nothing will rest in peace. So it is very, very important that lectures, religious lectures or spiritual lectures, bring some change even in the language in which we speak. So let his soul rest in peace. First of all, we don't agree with a concept called soul. It is better we call it Atma. What is soul? There is no definition for soul. You know what is the definition for Atma? Apnoti iti Atma. That is why it is called Atma. Apnoti means that which attains what it wishes to attain. I'll come again. Atma is called Atma because it attains what it wishes to attain. If the Atma wishes, it will attain what it wishes. So it is called Apnoti iti Atma. That is why Vedam tells Brahma vit apnoti param. If you keep meditating of Brahmam, you will attain Brahmam. So it is called Atma. So that is why elders in those days used to state that think of good incidents and keep speaking of it because there are astu devatas around you. So they'll be telling tathastu, tathastu. This has to do with the Atma too. Incidentally, you have The Alchemist, one of the famous books by Paulo Coelho, a Portugal writer. He tells that if you aspire for something in this world, keep thinking of it. Isn't this a borrowed concept from the concept of Atma? So you keep thinking of Brahmam, you will attain Brahmam. So, apnoti iti Atma. Now I will give a second interpretation to it. The father wants to study in Indian Institute of Science. He wishes, but he is not able to achieve. Now he will ensure that his daughter or son study there. So the father attains what he wishes to attain through the child. So the father's Atma is the child. You are getting the point? That is why when you describe Vyasa, what do we say? Vyasam Vasishtha Naptaram. He is the great grandson of Vasishtha. Shakti
Shaktev Pautram. He is the grandson of Shakti Maharishi. Parashara Atmajam. They don't say the word Putra. They say Atmajam. The Atma of Parashara is his son Vyasa. Because Parashara wanted to compose Mahabharata, he could not do. His son composed, so his Atma became his son. Here, Dasharatha kissed on the forehead of his son because Vedam tells that the father has to kiss on the son or the daughter's forehead. Telling this mantra. Even if you are not telling this mantra, at least kiss. Now, here, Vishwamitra finally understands that Dasharatha wanted his son Rama to come along with him. And he says, I will take Rama along and Lakshmana also comes. Lakshmana is so important in Ramayanam. I will cite two instances. Shurpanakha comes and proposes to Rama. Looking at, she was a widow. Who made her a widow? Very good. Ravana made her a widow. So when she came to Rama, she had the inner thought of avenging the death of her husband. So she thought, who is the one who can take on my brother Ravana? And when she looked at Rama, she knew he will be able to. When she reached Rama, Shatro Prakhyata Viryasya Ranjaneyasya Vikramaihi is a famous saying on Rama and Ramayanam. It seems more than his well-wishers praising him, his detractors will praise him. Imagine Raga telling a few nice words about Modi. So it is like that. Even detractors will praise him. Shatroho Prakhyata Viryasya Ranjaneyasya Vikramaihi. Shurpanaka's nose and ears were chopped off. Because of something that she did mischievously to Sita. She comes all the way complaining to her brothers Kara, Dushana and Trishiras, who were stationed in Janasthanam, which is current day Vidarbha or Nagpur region. So when she comes and complains, what should she tell? That man chopped off my nose. And she should have recited one Sahasranamam, abusive Sahasranamam she should have recited. But you know what she said? You know that those two handsome gentlemen, long arms, lotus-like eyes, beautiful teeth, they chopped my nose. Will you ever say this? Tarunau, Rupa Sampannau, Sukumarau, Mahabalau, Pundarika Visalakshau, Chira Krishnaji Nambarau. Why should she say that? Because when she thought of Rama, all that she could imagine was his such charming looks and qualities that even while she wanted to get abusive, that abusive Sahasranamam turned into a real Sahasranamam. Here you had detractors praising Rama. So she goes and tells her brothers, Bhrata chasyam mahateja gunatulyasya vikramaha anuraktascha bhaktascha lakshmano nama viryavan amarshi durjayo jeta vikranto buddhiman bali ramasya dakshino bahur nityam prano bahischaraha ramasya dakshino bahu. Generally we say it in English, right, sir? He is your right hand. In the ancient English, the classical colonial English, there is no such expression called as he is my right hand. Generally they will be wondering, Britishers, he is your right hand, where is your hand, they will ask. If he is your right hand, where is your... Because we literally translate what is said in our regional language. There is something called Indian English, like what I am speaking now. See, I used to wonder in certain lectures that I used to go in Delhi. The person used to say, morning I got up. So I used to wonder, morning you get up, what is morning? Hindi mein kehte hai na, subah subah mein utha. So that exactly gets translated to morning I got up. So I am sure all of you will relish my English. But if I were to go to the Downing Street or somewhere there, I will be literally thrown out. Because they will know that this is not the language that we have developed. So right hand is something that we use. We say he is his right hand. But in Sanskritam, there is a phrase, Dakshino Bahu. Dakshinam in Sanskrit means right. Vamam means left. Whenever you go around the sanctum sanctorum in your temple, your right hand side of the body always faces the Garbhagriham. Since your Dakshina Bhagam, your right hand side faces the Garbhagriham, this posture is called Pradakshinam. You do Pradakshinam, right? Because your right hand side faces. So it's called Pradakshinam. Dakshinam also means south. So you have to literally see which meaning to use. Vamam means left. Lord Krishna used to hold the butter ball in the left hand. If I go in Chennai, that person will be smoking. In a very orthodox fashion, he'll be doing, he'll be smoking. But when I give that 100 rupee note, in Chennai, auto rickshaws don't take anything like 49 or 50. They will take only in whole numbers, 100, 200. So if I give them a 100 rupee note, that person will say, sir, don't give it in your left hand, give it in your right hand. Because he believes this is a good omen. So that means he should stop smoking. So for a person who smokes, how does it matter in which hand I give? So he will say, give it in your other hand. Whereas Krishna used to have curd rice only from his left hand. Bhagavatam tells, Bibhradvenum jatarapathaya shringavetyecha kakshe vame panau masrila kabalam tatphalam angyulishu tishthan madye swapadi suhrudo hasayan narmabhisvaihi swarge loke mishati bhubuje yajnabhuk balakelihi vame panau masrila kabalam tells Shukabrahmam. It seems Krishna had a ball of curd rice in his hand. Masrila kabalam means curd rice. And on the other hand, he had pickles. I was telling this in Bombay. One person got really angry. He said, sir, that is why we don't let South Indians give discourses. He was in Madura. How can he have curd rice? I said, he could have had chapati. I am not denying it. But Bhagavatam tells only curd rice. What can I do? Bibhradvenum jatarapataya shringavetye chakakshe vame panau masrila kabalam is what it tells. But then he asked me, are you saying that wheat did not exist? I said, wheat existed. That is why in Vedam, in Chamakam section, you have Goduma Chame. Goduma means wheat. So wheat was used, but Krishna liked rice. How can I stop him from having rice? That is why I said he had a big tummy. See, isn't that a right way of connecting? Then he was satisfied with that. Here, we had Shurpanaka who went and complained to her brothers. She tells, Ramasya Dakshinobahum Nityam Pranayivaparaha. My dear brothers, I saw Rama and I saw Rama's right hand there. You know what was his name? His name was Lakshmana. So even a lady who saw Lakshmana at the first instance knew that they were inseparable. At one instance, when Lakshmana swooned on the battlefield in Lanka, Rama cries. He tells, Shakya Sita Samanari Martyaloke Vichinvata Na Lakshmana Samobhrata Sachivaha Samparayikaha. When Lakshmana swooned, Rama laments. He tells, if not finding a lady like Sita as my wife in this janmam, at least in the next janmam I can find a lady like Sita. But given a choice, I can never find an obedient brother like Lakshmana in any of my janmams. He has swooned, I cannot take it. So he tells. So this is the attachment what they had. They both walked. After they walked, Rama, after performing the morning oblations, he came in front of Vishwamitra. Vishwamitra said, I am going to teach you two mantras. It is called Bala Mantra and Atibala Mantra. Mantra Gramam Grihanam Tvam Balam Atibalam Tatha Nashramo Najvaro Vate Narupasya Viparyayaha. So, in those days, you had mantram which was used as the tonic. Matra Balam, Mantra Balam. Today also, Matra is only Balam. Like Matra only everybody takes. But Matra Balam means in how many seconds you recite that mantram. For example, I do not know how many of you have heard of this word called Abhivadaye. Abhivadaye is when an elderly person comes, this opposite person, mostly young, most of the times younger in age, falls at the feet of that elderly person. After he rises, he officially in a Vedic custom introduces himself. He tells, Abhivadaye, I will tell you my Abhivadanam. Abhivadaye, Angirasa, Ambarisha, Yavanasvat Trayarishaye Pravaranvita. Generally when you see universities or colleges advertising, they will say, notable alumni who have passed out of this institution. They will say a few names. Kiran Shah, Murthy. They will say 4-5 names. Likewise, if a rishi has to let his legacy continue, 3-4 rishis become notable alumni. That is called pravaram. So we say, Angirasa, Ambarisha, Yavanasvat, Trayarishaye, Pravaranvita. In which gotram I am coming? Harita Gotraha.
In which procedure do I follow in my house? Generally, for people who follow Yajurvedam, they may have Apastamba or Bodhayana. If you are following Samavedam, the Rishi will change. So you will say the name of the Rishi, Apastamba Sutraha. Which Vedam do you belong to? Yajushaka Adhyayi. What is your name? You have to tell your name and you should say Asmi Bhoho. You have to fall at that feet. Now this is stage one. The person whom you fall prostrate at the feet, the person who accepts that Abhivadanam should have the knowledge to accept it. Because Vedam tells when you accept it, you have to listen to the person's name and then you say Ayushman Bhava Harshavardhana Sharma. You have to extend for 3 seconds. Oh, sir, there is so much. That is why you should be very careful in before, because everybody is in a position to accept namaskarams. But you should be equivalently qualified enough to give it back. So this matra, even 3-4 seconds that you extend is called matra. That is for the mantram. So this mantram was used in those days to gain energy. Imagine, mantram was so prominent even in Dhanurvedam. Dhanurvedam talks about archery. You might have seen many of the earlier Telugu films. That person will come and stand on the battlefield and he will start singing. Olava. He will continue for 10 minutes on the battlefield. He will sing in Shanmuka Priya, Karahara Priya. Then he will do in Ragamalika itself. Then you might have seen that arrow that is being shot from the bow. You will be amazed to see, in those days it was amazement. Fire sparks will come. Then water will come. Both of them will meet. This is not the way where which battles were fought. Because the arrow will come at the bullet speed. So you cannot even think that arrow will not come like Grand Trunk Express. And it will not wait for the opposite arrow to come. And this person who is hitting will not tell the opposite person, I am going to hit Agnayastram. Be careful. Warning, warning, warning. Agnayastram. He will not say anything of that. Then how will the opposite person know what to shoot? You have to understand very carefully. There is a difference between Astram and Shastram. Shastram is any object or a weapon. This mic. Sir, mic is a weapon. You have not seen parliament sessions? So, any object is a weapon. It is a shastram. If I induce a mantram into the shastram, it becomes astram. So, the formula is shastram plus mantram is equal to astram. If I take the arrow, which is the shastram, and induce Agni mantram into it, it will become Agneyastram. If I induce Brahma mantram into it, it will become Brahmastram. Lord Shiva's mantram into it, it will become Pashupatastram. Correct. Now, the opposite person has to send an opposing weapon to me. How will he know? Because I am not announcing. When I take the arrow, I recite the mantram with the lip sync, right? From that lip sync, that person who stands 2 miles away from me has to read my lips very closely and know that he is hitting Agnayastram. And then he has to shoot. It is not the slowly the arrow will come and that arrow will be given time. The person, minute this arrow is shot, the nanoth of the second, the next arrow should come. That is why Arjuna was a very different warrior. You know what he used to do? He used to hit with both his hands. So he was called Savyasachi. Arjuna was called Savyasachi because he was ambidextrous in that extent. He could use both his hands simultaneously. No sir, we know only Shabyasachi. In the east of India, they convert Vakaram into Bakaram. I cannot help that. He is called Savyasachi. Savyasachi means one who uses both his hands. Now, likewise, mantrams can also be used to never attain fatigue. You can never become tired on reciting mantram. There were such mantrams in those days. Sir, should we learn that? Yes, very importantly for lectures. Because after 3 hours of lectures, people in the audience will say, so it is very tiresome to listen to 3 hours of lectures. Even delivering is easy. So we need one mantra even for that fatigue. That is why Dronacharya in those days was a person who never had fatigue. Here he tells, na shramo na jvaro vate, na jvaro. They will not get fever. Na rupasya viparyayaha, na cha suptam pramattam va, na cha suptam pramattam va. Pramattam, they will never forget. Suptam, they will not sleep unnecessarily. Darshayishyanti nairritaha, na bahvoho sadrisho virye, prithivyamasti kaschana. Prithivyam asti kaschana. Nobody can defeat you in this world if you follow this mantra, tells Vishwamitra. I had left one portion uncompleted. People think Lakshmana did not sleep for 14 years. That is a general misconception, because in Ramayanam itself, at one place in the forest, Rama tells Lakshmana, it is time, wake up. Rama wakes up Lakshmana in one instance. But why do we say that Lakshmana did not sleep? That is also true. See, in certain houses, if they have a marriage the next house, the parents will be so tensed, they will not be able to sleep well. But they know they need some rest. So they will sleep just like that. And even in a pin's drop noise, they will get up. So if you ask them, did you sleep? No, I didn't sleep at all, they will say. You cannot tell them, no, I shot one video on my mobile phone, you were sleeping. What they say is, we slept, but we did not have a sound sleep. So Lakshmana too slept, but he did not have a sound sleep because he thought something might come and hurt Rama, so I should always be on the vigil. Here, we had Vishwamitra who taught. The next day, the two brothers were sleeping. Lakshmana got up earlier and went to the river to bathe. It was around 4 a.m. in the morning. That is called Brahma Muhurtam. Technically, I do not know how that 4 a.m. looks like. I have never woken up at 4 a.m. But I tell you, Shastram tells Brahmecha Muhurtecha Uthaya. If one has to progress in this world spiritually, he has to wake up at 4 a.m. it seems. Those of you who wake up, kudos and accolades to you all. So, 4 a.m. Vishwamitra woke up. After 4 a.m. some elderly people do not get sleep. But he was looking at Rama. So, he wanted to wake up Rama. He sings the best of the shlokas. Kausalya supraja rama purva sandhya pravartate uttishtha narashadula kartavyam devamanhikam meluko vaiya mam meluko rama melaina sita sametana bhagya meluko vaiya. How beautifully Tyagaraja puts it. Some may be wondering, sir, we have heard this Kausalya Supraja Rama, but in Venkatesha Suprabhatam, how you are telling it is Valmiki's Ramayanam? The composer of Venkatesha Suprabhatam, called Prativadi Bhayankaram Annan, has imported this shloka from Valmiki Ramayanam. This is originally a Valmiki Ramayanam shlokam. Kausalya. The commentary for this shloka 1,000 years before by the commentator is for 10 pages, this shlokam. Kausalya. Whom is Vishwamitra waking up? Whom is he waking up? Rama. But what is the first word? Kausalya. Is Kausalya here? Kausalya. Why is he calling the child through his mother's name? Because Mata Putrasya Bhuyamsi Karmanya Rabhate is a Shastravakyam. On a child, whether it is a son or a daughter, the mother has 100 times more rights than the father, tells Shastra. Shastram tells like that. For a son too, or a daughter, when they do pindapradanam, the maximum pindams is for the mother, not the father. So, that mother's role in a life is very, very, very important. Mata putrasya bhuyamsi karmanya rabhate. So, thinking of this Shastra Vakyam, Vishwamitra, being a person who adheres to the rules mentioned in the Shastram, wanted to call Rama by his mother's name, Kausalya. Second, Shastram tells Matrudevo Bhava, Pitrudevo Bhava. This comes in Taitreyam. See, in Sanskritam, the general rule of grammar is you have to put letters in the alphabetical order. Pa, pa, ba, bha, ma. Pa is for pita, ma is for mata. Ideally, grammatically, it should have been Pitrudevo Bhava and Matrudevo Bhava. But why is it Matrudevo Bhava and Pitrudevo Bhava? Because mother is so important. How do we know? Apastamba, a great Maharishi, tells in Dharma Sutram, he tells, the son or the daughter is taking care of the parents. Imagine that the father is a characterless man. Then what to do? Apastamba tells, you have to chase him out of the house. He tells, on the contrary, if the mother is a characterless woman, what should you do? Even then, the son or the daughter have to keep the mother and protect her till the last minute. Mate etyeke is the Shastra Vakyam. So, thinking of all these Shastra Vakyams, Vishwamitra tells, Kausalya, there is a beautiful Kural in Tamil. One of the earliest saints to have written a beautiful treatise on the general ethics is called Thiruvalluvar. Thiruvalluvar generally is found in most of the government buses in Tamil Nadu. He will be a person with a long beard, one big shikha above his head, nothing on his forehead. I don't know where they got this picture of Thiruvalluvar. Thiruvalluvar was a true Vaishnavite. He tells, Agaramudala Yeduthellam Adi Bhagavan Mudatre Ulagu. Adi Bhagavan. There is no Tamil word called Adi. There is no Tamil word called Bhagavan. These are all Sanskrit words. So he tells, that is why in Tamil they say, Annayum Pitavum Munnari Devam. Annai is a Tamil word for the word mother. Pita is not the Tamil word, it is a Sanskrit word. In Tamil, the word for father is Tandai. Annayum Tandayum Munnari Devam. But they say Annayum Pitavum, agreeing that Tamil also respects Sanskrit as much as Sanskrit respects Tamil. But who is there in Tamil Nadu to listen to my lectures? They keep on lamenting something or the other. So, in Thirukural, Valluvar tells, Indra Purudir Periduvakum Tanmaganai Sandron Yenakettai. It seems the mother will be super elated when she listens from others that her child, be it a son or a daughter, is famous, not notorious, famous. And that happiness will be multitude times higher than the happiness that she acquired while delivering him. Indra Purudir Periduvakum Tanmaganai Sandron Yenakettai. So understanding all these statements that accord so much of importance to the mother, Vishwamitra tells Kausalya. This word Kausalya was told between 4 a.m. and 4-5 a.m. So 5 minutes it will take to tell Kausalya. No, no. Carnatic style it will take 5 minutes. Kausalya, 5 minutes. Next, Praja means child. Whose child? Kausalya's child. Kausalya, Praja. But he is not Praja. Praja means any normal child. But he was such an obedient child, so the poet wanted to add a prefix Su, means good child. Kausalya, Supraja. Now 4:10 to 4:15. This is over. Now after that, the next word is what? Huh? Rama. But he recited that name only at 5:45. Sir, 1.5 hours he took to recite Kausalya Supraja. Why? Because the next word Rama was given to this little boy by Vasishtha. So Vishwamitra will not openly agree, right? So he's thinking twice or thrice, what name will I call? Kausalya Supraja, Supraja Kausalya, Praja Kausalya, Supraja Kausalya, Supraja Kausalya. Kausalya Garinidapa. He did Neraval, he put Swaraprastharam, everything till 5:45. Then after that, what he did was, he put all the 1,000 names of the Lord onto a sieve. Those of you who have completed engineering at some point in time and fortunately managed to remember some of the courses by any chance, there is one analysis called sieve analysis in applied engineering. In sieve analysis, you put various sieves one over the other, you put some mud at the top of it and hit. What remains needs to be measured and the dimensions have to be measured, whether it's coarse or granular, and based on that, how you measure, they give you a certificate that you're a civil engineer, and we end up constructing buildings that end up falling during rainy season in Mumbai. So in that sieve analysis, you need to put the material at the top. What Vishwamitra did was, he put the 1,000 names of the Lord onto the sea. Vishwam, Vishnur, Vashatkaraha, Devaki Nandanaha, Srashta, Kshitichaha, Papanashanaha, Aniruddhaha, Pradhyumnaha, everything together. And he started hitting the sea. He wanted to check what remains at the bottom. He had only one name, which is Ramanama. So he said, in this world, I have tried my level best through my penances and valor to match the splendor of that Brahmarishi called Vasishta. If there is one place where I have miserably failed, is when here, there could have never been a better name that anybody could have coined. It is Vasishta who has won over me. Kausalya Supraja Rama Purva Sandhya Pravartate. Now it was exactly morning, 5:45. Uttishtha, wake up. Nara Shardula, the one who is like a tiger amongst men. Kartavyam Daivam Anhikam. You have to do your duties, wake up. This is what most translation books tell. But the great Pravachana Karta of the century called Sengalipuram Anantarama Dikshitar used to state, it was not to wake up Rama, to ask him to perform his duties. It seems Vishwamitra said, Rama, every day I look at the middle of the sun, every morning, and take water in my hands and put Argyam to it. Because I keep viewing Lord Narayana, who is the Paramatma, in the middle of the sun. Dheyas sada savitrimandala madhyavarti. But today I am so fortunate that that Narayana has come in front of me. Why do I need to look at the sun? I can look at you and give that Argyam. So for me to perform my duties, you have to wake up. Kartavyam Devamanhikam. But Tyagaraja, look at the way he wakes up. He thinks Vishwamitra, being a rishi, did not know the exact nuance how to wake up. He tells, I will wake up Vishwamitra, says Tyagaraja. Rama, wake up. Only if you wake up, you can marry Sita. Melaina Sita Sameta Na Bhagya Ma Meluko Vaiya Mam Yeluko Rama. They woke up. And as Rama woke up, he saw Lakshmana coming after doing the Paramam Japam. Ramayanam tells Paramam Japam. What is that Paramam Japam? That is Gayatri. Gita Ganga cha Gayatri Govinde cha Hridisthite Chaturgagara Samyukte Punarjanmana Vidyate. Gita, Bhagavad Gita, whenever one listens to it and internalizes. See, it's very important. Somebody asked me, sir, why don't you give lectures on Bhagavad Gita? Always Ramayanam and Mahabharatam, we are bored. Give on Bhagavad Gita, because in our minds itself, we have construed that Ramayanam and Mahabharatam is level 1. Bhagavad Gita is like postgraduate level. I have of course been fortunate enough to learn Gita along with its commentaries under my Acharya, Srivatsankacharya, for 2 years. Nevertheless, I told that person that I have not matured of that age in my wisdom to speak of Bhagavad Gita. People, it is very easy to give a lecture on Bhagavad Gita, but one should follow it first and then preach. Preaching is very easy. So you have to internalize Bhagavad Gita. Gita, Ganga. Ganga waters have been treated by our Shastram so well. On Deepavali, before that day, what Chaturdashi it is called? Naraka Chaturdashi. Why is it called Naraka Chaturdashi? Huh? Narakasura was killed. So, killing of Narakasura, we are all enjoying. Correct? We are all very barbaric. Are we in India or Syria? Huh? Why should we enjoy the death of a demon? So, Naraka Chaturdashi, in the word sense, doesn't have anything to do with Narakasura. Of course, Narakasura had imprisoned many women of marriageable age, and Krishna had to relieve them and killed him. But not to commemorate the death of one person, we are celebrating Naraka Chaturdashi. Naraka in Sanskritam is defined as Nrinam Prapayati. So, Nrinam Prapayati means that which helps you bring something which is very far off, very close to you. I will repeat it. Something which is very far off, very good, if that is being brought very close to you, it is called Naraka in Sanskritam. Ganga water is somewhere. But Ganga waters have to be brought to the red color plastic bucket in my house. So how will I bring Naraka? On that Chaturdashi, the Lord tells, on that day alone, Ganga by her mere spiritual presence attains your red color plastic bucket. So that is why a common question which people ask on the day of Naraka Chaturdashi is, have you had Ganga Snanam? Because that day alone Ganga comes to our house. As per Shastram, you should not consume water that has been preserved in a bottle or any container for more than 24 hours. That is why in those days they used to go to the river every day and take water and come. They never had stored water. But there is an exception to the general rule, which is Ganga water. Ganga water alone can be preserved for years together. That is why they used to bring those small pots of Ganga water in those days. Gita, Ganga, cha Gayatri. Gayatri mantram is a paramam japam. Govindeti hridisthite. The shabdam Govinda, Gavam Indraha Govindaha, tells Adi Shankara Bhagavad Pada in his Bhashyam. Govinda also means the one who gives good speech. Govinda also means the one who has uplifted Mother Earth from the deluge waters when the demon called as Hiranyaksha threw her away. That is why in Sahasranamam you have got the name Govinda repeating 3 or 4 times. Govindo Govidam Patihi. So you will have 4 instances where Govinda Namam comes. When Draupadi wanted the Lord to help, she said, Pundarikaksha Govinda Rakshamam Sharanagatam. She called the name of Govinda. That is why the Pattabhishekam, which the Lord took place after Govardhana Parvatodharanam, is called Govinda Pattabhishekam. So here Gayatri Mantram was recited. As I have said, what is the connection between Gayatri Mantram and Ramayanam? Sir, when did you say? Those of you who have come today, may kindly cross-check the written notes with your Saidi and take Xerox of it. Here, as the trio, that is Vishwamitra, Rama and Lakshmana, were walking in the front, they saw and they heard the sound of a demoness. Rama asked, who is this demoness? Immediately he sent, there was a king called as Yaksha, king called as Suketu. Suketu had a daughter called Tataka, who was married to a demon called as Sunda. They had 2 sons called Maricha and Subahu. Once they tried to disturb the penance of Agastya. Agastya is called as the Kumbhamuni because he arose from a Kumbham. And he is the one who absolved Vatapi. Vatapi Jirno Bhava. This comes in Aranya Kandam, later we will see. So Agastya was a very short rishi, and it is believed by all our Puranams that he is the one who developed the South Indian languages. Agastya Sha. You will be surprised to know, one, the South Indian languages are called Agastya Bhasha. The second is, have you heard of Agatti Kirai? Kannadalli yen heltira? Soppu, kirege soppu, Agatti andre? Agasye na? Agastye. Agase. Oh, okay. So Agase. But in Sanskritam, you know what it is called? It is called Agastya Shakha. That particular spinach, when consumed regularly, will lead to very good memory power. You try it next time. Next time, before you come for June lectures, you consume Agastya Shakha and you see how the effect is. That is why on the day of Dwadashi, when your stomach is empty because of Ekadashi Vratam, if at all you have fasted, not feasted. Between fast and feast, the difference is only of the letter E. So if at all you have fasted by any means, then on the Dwadashi day, you are asked to consume Agastya Shakha. Because that will lead to very good memory. So, Rakshasastvam Bhajasveti Maricham Vyajaharasaha. So, this Kumbhamuni called as Agastya cursed these antisocial elements called as Tataka and her son Maricha and Subahu to roam in the forest as demons. So they started disturbing the yagyams that were performed by the rishis, especially that of Vishwamitra, for which he sought the help of Dasharatha's son Rama. So when they heard this wailing noise of Tataka, That is when Rama said, who is this lady? First of all, Vishwamitra said, how do you know she is a lady? No, she looks like a lady. Physical characteristics say so. Don't go by the physical characteristics of any man or woman. It is the innate characteristics that determines whether he is a man or a woman. We say at times, sir, don't call him, he barks. What do we mean? That means externally he is a man, internally he may be like a dog. We say he is a cunning fox, sir. That means he has that cunning habit like that of a fox in him. So she may externally appear to be so like a woman, but she has no qualities of a woman. A woman is supposed to be the personification of mercy. She has no mercy at all, Rama. She puts her hands inside the womb of a pregnant mother, takes the fetus and consumes the fetus. Do you call her a woman now? Rama tells, sir, this is my first battle. My CV is practically empty. Now if I shoot at this woman, then immediately that night, Arnab Goswami will debate. Rama has killed a woman. Justice for hashtag, justice for Tataka. And immediately he will call 10 people on the panel and all of them will simultaneously shout, sir. I don't want that to happen, Vishwamitra. So what do I do? Are there any precedents? See, even if you look at Supreme Court or High Court judgments, the judge will say, after writing the judgment, in 1973, Allahabad High Court, Judge Mishra said, a similar case, that person would have given judgment. So this judge will act very careful. He'll tell, see, what judgment I am giving, don't question me. If you're questioning me, go and question 1973 judgment. Even that person gave the same judgment. So this is called looking at precedents. So Rama tells, now if I'm ready to shoot at this woman, then people will ask me. Then I have to give them precedents. Can you give me precedents? That is when he tells, Shruyate hi pura shakraha vairochana sutam nripa prithivim hantum ichanti mantharam abhyasudayat. Once, Indra killed a lady called as Manthara. So there is a precedent where if a woman acts contrary to the dharmam, the other person has the right to punish. Manthara was punished by Indra. Is there any other precedent, sir? Asked Rama. That is when he tells, Vishnuna chapura rama bhrugupatni pativrata anidram lokamichanti kavyamata nishudita kavyamata nishudita. Bhrugu had two wives, primarily two. Whatever little I know of Puranams, two. One was called Khyati, the other one was called Kavyamata. Kavyamata and Bhrigu had a son called Shukra. Who is Shukra? Shukracharya. So, Bhrigu was a great devotee of the Lord. Whereas, because Bhrigu's wife Kavyamata clandestinely had a pact with the Asuras and wanted to bring down the kingdom, the Lord killed Bhrigupatni, who's Kavyamata, with a chakram. Understanding that his mother was killed, Shukracharya became an antagonist and he went and joined the Asuras as Asura Guru. But Shukracharya is the brother to Mahalakshmi, because in one of the incarnations, Lakshmi was born as the daughter of Bhrigu. She is called Bhargavi. So Bhargavi is Mahalakshmi, her brother is Shukra. That is why on Shukravaram, Mahalakshmi prefers the most. You've got the connection? Here, Anidram lokamichanti kavyamata nishudita. Kavyamata was killed that day. So this is another precedent. Rama said, sir, you have cited some reasons. Now understanding your position, I have got three reasons why I can kill her. One, you have given me precedents. Second, my father has said, whatever Vishwamitra tells, you have to follow. Piturvachana nirdeshat piturvachana gauravat. So I have to upkeep my father's words. Third, you are a great Brahmarishi and you will never say anything that is contrary to Shastram. So I have to trust you. And he wanted to just handicap or make sure that she was relieved of her weapons. But she was so torturous and was so cunning and was so strong that Rama had no option but to kill her. How did he kill her? Kamban, the great Tamil poet of the 9th and the 10th century in Tamil Nadu, in Kambaramayanam tells, Sholluvakkum kadiyavega chudasaram kariyashemmal alluvakkum nirattinal mel vidalum adu vairakkunjin kalluvakkum nenjir tangadu appuram kalandru kalla pullarku nallor sonna porul yana poyittandre. It seems the arrow that got shot from the bow of Rama went like the words that come from a person's mouth. Sholluvakkum, why? Because generally if you go ask people, why did you tell that man such words? No sir, I did not want to tell, it came out of my mouth. So it means that the words are not under my control. Like how the words which are not under my control, the arrow which was not even under the control of Rama was shot from his bow. Shalluvakkum kadiyavega chudusaram. How was she? She was looking like a rock of diamond, because diamond is one of the hardest substances known in physics, because it's composition itself is very tight. The atomic structure of diamond is very strong. So, Vairakkunrin kalluvakkum nenjir thangadu, that arrow did not manage to stay in her body. It tore open her back. Appuram kalandru kalla pullarku. It continued further. Kalla pullarku nallor shonna porul ena poithandre. At what speed did it go after piercing her body from the backside? It went at that speed where a good cultured, civilized man calls a barbaric and an uncivilized man and advises in what speed the advice will be taken and go out of this year. At that speed it went, it seems. Kalla pullarku nallor shonna porul ena poithandre. So as Tataka Vadham happened, they describe Tataka as the one who wore an ethnic garland of the skeletons that were strung together of killed elephants. It seems she used to kill elephants. So if there is some precedent to Veerappan, she is one. So she used to kill elephants, consume the flesh and the blood, and used to preserve the skeleton. She preserved 1,000 such elephant skeleton and constructed a garland and put around her neck. And that garland came only till her abdomen. So the poet tells, imagine what size she would have been. Here, Rama handicapped her and finally killed her. Going further, Vishwamitra was super impressed with Rama's valor and taught him other missiles. Vajramastram narasreshtha shaivam shulavaram tatha astram brahma shirashchaiva aishikam api raghava. He taught him various forms of missiles. He taught one type of a missile called as aishikam. You know what does aishikam mean in Dhanurvedam? Aishikam is a special way of shooting arrow where you don't even see your destination, but you keep listening to the noise and give. That's called Shabdavedi. A sub part of it is when you do not have weapons around you, but you see an enemy approaching you, and you do not have time to go take your quiver of arrows and your bow, and you're just left with a nanoth of a second. What can you do? You can take a blade of grass, insert the mantram into the blade of grass, and leave it. This process of converting, the first one was Shabdavedi, where Dasharatha left his arrow towards the elephant and finally it fell on Shravanakumara. Here it is Aishikam, where Rama was taught how to use Aishikam. When will this be used? In Kakasura Vrittantam, in Crow, he takes that blade of grass and leaves it. That is why there is a saying in Tamil. I'm sure there will be one in Kannada and Telugu too. Vallavanukku pullum ayudam. So for the one who is adept in archery, even a blade of grass can turn into a weapon is what this old saying has to say. Here, we had Vishwamitra who taught him various kinds of missiles. Aishikam api raghava. And they enter Siddhashramam. Siddhashramam was one place. Rama immediately asks, what is this Siddhashramam? Sir, can you tell me the story? Note this point very clearly. Rama made it sure that he used every opportunity to acquire knowledge. See, we say, oh, he's telling Ramayana. Ramayana and all I know very well. Why should I come for Ramayana? Let him tell some unknown topic, I will come. So, if we have this habit in our minds, then spiritual progress becomes very tough. Because I'll tell you why. The same Ramayanam, same Rama, marrying the same Sita, annihilating the same Ravana, could be heard by you from at various stages in your life. But remember, the story remains the same. The morals that you try to extract from the story differs from stage after stage. To a youngster who is in his adolescence, who is going to his college, where his hormones are active, when I tell Ramayana, what will impress him is Annarum Nokinan, Avalum Nokinal. But to an old person who has his children and daughters married, what may bring that enlightenment is when I tell Dasharatha had to wait for his son to come from the other country for his last rites to be performed. So the same story appeals to various genres of the audience in a different way. So the same story has to be heard in various stages. But why did I bring Rama's point into picture is Vedanta Deshika tells, Kushika Sutta Kathita Vidita Nava Vividha Katha. Kushika Sutta, Vishwamitra. Kushika Sutta Kathita, narrated. Vishwamitra narrated. Kushika Sutta Kathita Vividha Nava Vividha Katha. So Rama heard many stories. Nava. You know what does the word Nava in Sanskritam mean? Nine. Any other meaning? New. Very good. Nava means nine. Nava means new. He heard new old stories. Can you tell like that? If they are old, how can they be new? If they are new, how can they be old? He heard the same old stories in a contemporary fashion. See, it is very, very important for a speaker to reach the audience of the current generation. When I started my discourses and I used to give examples from cell phone, some people used to get really angry at me. Why are you bringing cell phone? They all pollute. These words pollute the content of the lectures. Be very pure, like how Anantaramadikshitar gave. Anantaramadikshitar gave in 1960. That time there was neither cell phone, no Arnab Goswami, no Times Now, nothing. So we had no such channels, no technology. At that stage, he gave lectures catering to that generation. In this stage, I have to give stories catering to this generation. It cannot be rendered the same way Valmiki told Rama. Imagine, Arjuna asked this question, can I fight my own grandfather and brothers? Had I been in Krishna's position, it's very tough to imagine. Let us imagine, had I been in Krishna's position, I would have said, see, I have come all the way from Dwaraka as your charioteer. You want to fight, you fight, else I am going back. This is what I would have said. You know what Krishna said? Atma is different, Shariram is different. Atma is eternal, Shariram is perishable. The difference between the two is many. The difference between you and me is also many. Bahuni me vyatitani janmani tavacharjuna. Hey Arjuna, listen, there are two primary ways of reaching me. One is Bhakti Yogam, second is Sharanagati. Bhakti Yogam uses Jnana Yogam and Karma Yogam as the Angam. So you have to perform Ashtanga Yogam, do Parabhakti, then acquire Paragnanam and finally reach Paramabhakti, have the habit of Twara and reach me. Arjuna finally forgot what question he asked. He asked whether I can fight or not. And look at the list of answers that come. Now, all these answers came in the form of 700 verses called Bhagavad Gita. Krishna did not explain every shloka. He just uttered the shlokas. 700 shlokas he uttered. In 1.5 hours he uttered. Arjuna kept listening. Arjuna understood everything and started fighting. But today, to explain that 700 verses, we need close to 150 hours. Word by word I have to go. So, in that stage, Arjuna could understand 700 verses. But times have changed where for explaining every verse, we need 2 hours. So, times change and we have to change our techniques too. So, Rama heard from Vishwamitra old stories in a new form. Nava Vividha Katha. So, what is the other moral that we derive? The other moral is, listening is the biggest asset in one's life. What is the biggest asset? No, sir, I have invested in bitcoins. That is my biggest asset. I don't know when it will be regulated or not regulated. That can go away any day. But the biggest asset one enjoys in life is listening. Listening is even stronger than writing and reading. Remember this. To those prospective parents here or grandparents, my only humble, fervent suggestion from the bottomest of my heart, how much ever bottom I can get, is make sure children at a very young age listen to a lot of lectures. Don't think that they will not be able to understand. Don't come to this conclusion. See, we all come here with the assumption that we are understanding. But whether that happens or not is not sure. So what rights do we have to understand that the child will not understand? So we should give ample opportunity to the child. The child will be able to grasp really well. So listening is an important aspect in one's life, especially in spirituality and theology. You cannot progress without listening. No, sir. Like Ramana Maharshi, if I go sit inside the cave like Rajinikanth, I will get. See, I don't know whether they get it or not. Ramana Maharshi was a great icon of the millennium. We cannot compare ourselves to great Maharishis like them. We are all normal people, primitive mortals. So we have to work really hard. Comparing ourselves to the Paramacharya of Kanchi, Ramana Maharishi, Vyasa or Valmiki is not going to serve any purpose. We are nowhere there. So for us, listening is the biggest asset. So every day you should make it a point to listen to 1 or 2 hours. Nobody says sit and listen. You can cook and listen. You can drive. Even while lot of people while driving, they listen, they get time. And especially in Bangalore traffic, you spend most of your time in driving. At least you will be listening to Ramayanam and Moksham when you're driving. So listen. Listening is the biggest art. That is why Prahlada tells, Shravanam Kirtanam Vishnoho Smaranam. Who is greater? Is the person who renders the discourse great? No, the person who listens is great. Because you keep listening, that listening will kindle so many thoughts in you. So Nava Vividha Katha, Rama listened. See, Rama did not have to listen to any of the stories. There was no need. Why did he do that? To become a lesson to the generations further. So he asked, how did this Siddhashramam come? So he tells, Yesha Purvashramo Rama Vamanasya Mahatmanaha Siddhashrama Iti Khyataha Siddho Hyatra Mahatapaha. This is the place where Kashyapa with his wife Aditi performed penance to obtain the Lord as their son. And finally the Lord was born as a dwarf called as Upendra or Vamana. This Upendra or Vamana, later seeking alms, went to the Yajnavatika of Balichakravarti and grew in height as Trivikrama. So this is what was, this is the incident that happened here. Tells Vishwamitra, later, hey Rama, this Siddhashramam became Kamashramam. How? Because Lord Shiva was married to Parvati, Himavan's daughter. Now, only a child that is being produced by their marriage will be able to vanquish a demon called as Tarakasura. So, to understand what had happened, the celestials went and found Shiva was seated in Virasanam. Virasanam means where the Lord bends one leg and extends the other leg. It's called Virasanam. So he was seated in Virasanam doing penance. Immediately they all came to Indra. Indra said, to get the demon vanquished, I need a son. How will I get a son when he is in penance? So he immediately deployed Operation Manmatha. So Manmatha was called. This has been described in detail in over 500 to 1000 verses called Kumara Sambhavam by Kalidasa. So Manmatha comes. Manmatha comes with his wife Rati. Manmatha in Krishna avataram is born as Pradyumna, remember, and Rati is born as Mayavati, not our Mayavati, the other Mayavati. So this is the other Mayavati, she was born. So Rati Devi and Manmatha came, they said, we are at the disposal of Indra. Indra said, I am launching Operation Manmatha, you have to go and kindle that interest of love and passion in Shiva. So Manmatha goes and stands with his flower bow. There is one old song in Tamil, Manmathan Leelayai Vendrar Undo. So while he was standing at the corner to hit an arrow at Lord Shiva, Parvati came and offered lotuses at the feet of Lord Shiva. This is what Kalidasa tells. Kalidasa is a wonderful poet. When you read his poetry, you will know what kind of imagination he had. Generally, people who come on the British education system will say, he is the Shakespeare of India. I absolutely disagree with that. Shakespeare is the Kalidasa of Europe. Why will he be the Shakespeare of India? Did Kalidasa come first or Shakespeare come first? So there is one saying, there is no poet in this world who has not borrowed thoughts from other poets. I am sure Shakespeare would have had access to Kalidasa's works. You know, 1000 years back, there was a great Arab traveler called as Al-Biruni. His books are called Al-Biruni's Indica. He says, I came all the way from the Arab world and I'm walking by the streets of India and I can feel, stand and see people talking Vedanta in the middle of the streets, he writes in Arabian language. So we had travelers coming from other countries, from China, visiting India's philosophical knowledge. So it will be absolutely not a matter of prestige but embarrassment to call him as a Shakespeare of India. We don't have a problem in calling Shakespeare as the Kalidasa of Europe. So Kalidasa is one of the greatest poets you can ever see in the language of Sanskritam. He tells, when the lotus was placed by Parvati on Lord Shiva, Lord Shiva opened his eyes and looked at the bimba fruit-like lips of Parvati and immediately thought, how did this even thought of looking at her lips strike me, and he looks around and he finds Manmatha standing with the bow and the arrow fitted to it. He immediately opens his third eye and burns him to ashes. So this person, Manmatha, loses his body, all his angam. So Manmatha is called Ananga. He is also called Kama. In Tamil, Manmatha is called as Maran. Again, don't get confused with any other Maran, you know. Maran means Manmatha. That is why Papanasam Shivan tells, Marajana Kankumara Janakan Malai Meedurai Bhavan Parkadal Alai Meel Tuyil Bhavan Pavanan Maramanan Umma Ramana Malaradi Pani Maname Diname Ma Ramanan Marajanakan. Maran means Manmatha or Kama. Since Kama was burned to ashes in this ashramam, He Rama tells Vishwamitra, this is called Kama Ashramam. They proceed further. That is when he tells, you have to do Yajna Samrakshanam. It was done for Shatratri, 6 nights. So Rama said, Lakshmana, you stand as a constant. I will be the variable. In algebra, we have variables and constants, right? I will go around the Yajnavatika and protect. So when Subahu and Maricha came, Rama shot the astram. He killed Subahu and drove away Maricha. Sashivadana Bhaktajanavana Shankarane Talagalena Sashivadana Pasitalamande Muniyagamunani Bahuparakrama Manure Nuraka Sashivadana. Muniyagamunani, the one who protected the Muniyagam, tells Tyagaraja. So after having vanquished Subahu and driving away Maricha, they proceed further. That is when they reach the banks of the large river flowing again Ganga. So Rama asks, can you tell me about Ganga? So immediately he tells, there was a king called Himavan. He had a wife called Mena. They had two girls. The first girl was called Ganga. The second was called Uma. Uma married Lord Shiva. Ganga initially existed in the Kamandalam of Brahma. When the Lord came as Vamana and extended his feet as Trivikrama, the foot of the Lord was reaching Satyalokam. For those of you who attended the Bhagavatam lectures in Banashankari will be aware that I told you the format of the Lokam. Bhuhu, Bhuvaha, Suvaha, Mahaha, Janaha, Tapaha, Satyam, Atala, Vitala, Sutala, Rasatala, Talatala, Mahatala, Patala. Now you have to imagine in a 3D shape. It should seem like an egg to you. Now in that, the topmost lokam at the topmost part is called Satyalokam. So when the Lord extended his foot, the reverse part of the foot was visible to Brahma, and Brahma wanted to be hospitable to the Lord and do Agya Puja or Pada Puja. So he took Ganga waters in his Kamandalam and washed the feet of the Lord. The washed waters is what the Paramabhakta accepts, and that is why Lord Shiva accepted in his, on his head. That is why Purandaradasa tells, Dharage Dakshina Kaveri Tira Kumbhapura Vasanuni Ne Karadalli Vinayaga Navamadida Huraga Bhushananuni Ne Koralalli Bhasma Rudrakshava Dharisida Parama Vaishnavanuni Ne Garudagamana Shri Purandara Vithalage Prana Priyanu Nine Chandra Chuda Shiva Shankar Parvati Ramanane Ninage Namo Namo Parama Vaishnava Vishnavana Maham Shambhu. So going further, Vishwamitra explains that, hey Rama, in your ancestors there was a king called Sagara Maharaja. Sagara had two wives. I told you in most of our Puranas, this wives concept will exist. Don't ask me why. Now, the first wife had a son called Asamanjas. His name was Asamanjas and he was like that. The second wife had 60,000 sons. Is it even easy to imagine? Your grandchildren will ask, who? That Dushyant said 60,000 sons. That is why I'm telling you, Pati, don't go to his lectures. Shashti putra sahasrani tumbhate dadvini smritaha dhritapurneshu kumbheshu dhatyastran samavardhayan dhritapurneshu kumbheshu. All the 60,000 children were born out of kumbham, which is petri dish, which is in vitro fertilization. Kumbham, if the child has to be born out of a kumbham, it comes out of a petri dish. So, in that case, if a mother is made to produce more eggs in one cycle, then you count the number of cycles, you can have so many children. So, if there is cryo-freezing these days, it can happen. So, to imagine that 60,000 is not possible is very difficult. If I tell, he had so many wives, sir, how can a person have more than one wife? Some asked me. I said, you should visit Chennai. So, we know of many people even in Kali Yugam having. So, what is the problem there? Here, Shashti, 60,000 sons. So, the Sagara Chakravarti performed Ashwamedha Yajnam. In Ashwamedha Yajnam, there is a sacrificial horse tied to the altar, the post. So, somebody kidnapped it. Who would have done that? Indra. See, in those days, if anything is missing or anything goes wrong, all fingers will point towards Indra only. Today it points towards Indrani. There it will point towards Indra. Tasya parvanitam yajnam yajamanasya vasavaha rakshasim. Don't tell all this to others outside. Rakshasim tanumasthaya yajnayam ashvatha harat. So Indra kidnapped. So as far as whatever little Puranam I know, there are 7 FIRs that one can file against Indra. But no action was taken. So, but in Vedam there is a mantram. Indra yaswaha. You have to give havis to Indra. Now our question is, sir, when Indra is abducting and misbehaving with women, why should we give havis to Indra? Very pertinent question. In Vedam, whenever you see names like Indra, Shambhu, Prajapati, Brahma, Narayana, it will all point only to Narayana. This is the rule cited by Sayanacharya in his commentary. All these words indicate the Lord. It does not indicate that Indra of Menaka and Urvashi. So this does not go to him. Here, after having understood that the horse has been abducted, Sagara Chakravarti tells, all my 60,000 sons go in search of the horse. So they do not know what to do. So they start digging the earth. They have found everywhere else. Horizontally it was not available. They start digging. So wherever they dug the earth, water started filling in. Since Sagara Putras dug and water started filling in, it is called Sagaram. So water started coming in, and as they dug earth further, they found the hoods of Adisesha. Because remember, Mother Earth is supported by the Lord himself as Adisesha under the earth. Uragam. That is why they say when you scale the earth down to the crust, you can see snake-like coils around the earth inside. So it is believed that Adisesha rests. So they said they cannot find the horse anywhere. Then they went to a lokam where there was an ashramam of Kapila, because this Indra tied the horse to Kapila ashramam and went. Where is Kapila ashramam? Have you heard of Ganga Sagar? What is Ganga Sagar? Ganga Sagar is the place where Ganga meets the ocean. It is in West Bengal. So you have to go to Calcutta. From Calcutta you have to take another vehicle and go. From that vehicle you have to take a jeep and go. Then you have to cross in a boat and then reach that place. If you go to Ganga Sagar where Ganga meets the ocean, you will see one small temple for Kapila. So that is the place where Kapila Ashramam existed. So in that Kapila Ashramam, the horse was tied. Kapila was doing penance. Maharishi Kapila Acharya Kritagyome Dhini Patihi. Remember in Sahasranamam, he is called as Sankhya Yoga Pravartaka Acharya, the one who brought Sankhya Yogam. Here, when the horse was tied, Indra, the sons of Sagara thought that he must have abducted. They immediately caught Kapila. And Kapila did not know why they are catching me. Immediately he opened his eyes and said, Hum! Humkaram iti bhava. Immediately the 60,000 sons got burnt and they turned into ashes. Sagara is waiting 2 hours over, my sons have not come, why? Immediately he sends his other son, Asamanjas. Asamanjas goes And as true to his name, Asamanjam, he acts and he does not know what to do. He comes back. Later, Garuda comes and tells the son of Asamanjas. Asamanjas' son was called Amshuman. Why did Garuda come? Because Garuda's own sister was the mother to the 60,000 sons. Her name was Keshini. So, forgive me, Sumati. So, Sumati is the sister to Garuda, and Garuda, being the uncle to those 60,000 people, comes and tells Asamanja's son, called as Amshuman, that until the waters of Ganga comes to the earth, these 60,000 sons can never gain their form and can never be emancipated. Then Amshuman had a son called Dilipa, and Dilipa had a son called Bhagiratha. Bhagiratha goes and performs penance. He performs penance for years together, and finally Brahma appears. Brahma tells, I will pour Ganga water, whatever has been washed off the feet of Trivikrama, onto the earth. But the only thing is, if Ganga waters come in its full force to the earth cannot withstand. So there should be a speed breaker somewhere. So immediately Bhagiratha said, now I have to go in search of the speed breaker. You tell me, where is that speed breaker? He tells, none but Lord Shiva can accept Ganga on. So he prays to Lord Shiva, and Lord Shiva appears, and Shiva says, I will take Ganga on my head. And all the water comes to Shiva's head, and from Shiva's head branches out one branch that spreads itself into three. Three branches go to the east, three to the west, one to the south. The one that goes to the southern direction is called Bhagirathi, because she follows the chariot of Bhagiratha. Three goes towards the west, three goes towards the east. Generally, rivers that go westward is called as Nada. Rivers that go eastward is called Nadi in Sanskrit. So both are not referred to as Nadi. For example, if you take rivers like Narmada, it is Nada. If you take a river like Kaveri, it is Nadi. So Nada Nadi Bhavam is a very important rule in Sanskrit grammar. Nevertheless, she is called Tripathaga. Tripathaga. She takes three routes, because she has travelled in the east, she has travelled in the west, she is travelling in the south. The other meaning, since she was in Brahma's Kamandalam, Lord Vishnu's feet, and Lord Shiva's head, she is called Tripathaga. So Tripathaga started following Bhagiratha, hence it is called Bhagiratha Prayatnam. So if somebody works very hard and accomplishes something, it is called Bhagiratha Prayatnam. Ganga started following. Ganga got really haughty. She entered the hermitage of a rishi called Janhu. Janhu was performing yagam. So while she wanted to obstruct the yagam because of her arrogance, Janhu consumed her totally to prove that Vedic person can do anything. Finally, she sought remorse, and then she emerged out of the year. Since she emerged out of the year of Janhu, she is treated as the daughter of Janhu, and hence she is called Janhavi. Muthuswami Dikshitar brings this essence in one kirtana. Gange mam pahi girisha shire sthite gambhira gaye sangeeta vadya priye amba gange mam pahi Angajatatamude Asivaruna Madhye Akrura Pujite Akhila Jananande Sakala Tirthamule Sadguru Guhalile Varajanhubale Vyasadi Kripale Gange Mampahi Varajanhubale. She is called as a daughter of Janhu, and hence Janhavi. So Ganga followed. As she reached the ashes, she gave life and emancipation to the 60,000 sons who were burned to ashes. At the same time, she continued flowing in India, thereby evoking and removing the sins of many. Whenever I used to hear this from acharyas, if you bathe in this river, sins will go away. Logically, it is untenable. Whatever sins I commit, if I go and go to a river, if all the sins will go away, then everybody will come to that river. So what is the meaning of that? See, rivers, when they start from their origin, for example, you take Ganga, Yamuna, or Tamraparani, or Siruvani, or Kaveri, or Sharavati, they start from the mountains. Since they come through various herbs and medicinal plants, they carry the medicinal effect in them. Whenever you take bath in them in a proper or a prescribed fashion, through from the head to toe, those cool medicinal waters give a lot of relaxation to your mind. Continuous bathing in that river will give bliss. Over a period of time, whatever sins we have committed, we start seeking remorse for it. Oh, I shouldn't have committed this. I shouldn't have committed that. So when this paschatapam comes, the prayaschittam happens. So bathing in a river may not directly solve. It is a stage by stage process. So we need to understand to connect A is greater than B, B is greater than C, C is greater than D, A is greater than D. So that A is greater than D will come through these sub stages. Here, we had Ganga who relieved, hey Rama, you are witnessing that Ganga here. But why did Rama have to ask the story of Ganga? Because Rama wanted to internally and innately tell Vishwamitra, that day Ganga arose from my feet and she gave emancipation to the sons of Sagara. Today that feet which gave birth to Ganga will give emancipation to Ahalya, and you will see this. So to give that indication, he continues. Further, he tells about the birth of Kartikeya or Muruga, who we call in the south. So Kumara Sambhavam comes in Ramayanam too. And that is why they say, if you listen to this Kumara Sambhavam, Putra Pautrad Bhavishyati, your sons and your grandchildren will live very happily. So this comes as Kumara Sambhavam in Srimad Ramayanam too. Then, continuing further, we have where Rama goes in the front and then he sees Vishwamitra walking at the back. He says, Vishwamitra, you please go in the front. They keep going. That is when they reach the hermitage of Gautama. As Rama kept walking, suddenly Vishwamitra turns behind to see that there is somebody new, and there was a lady called Ahalya. So he was amazed. Then Rama asked, Vishwamitra, you are amazed and I am also amazed. Who is this lady? Vishwamitra tells, her name is Ahalya. She was once a unique creation of Brahma. Upon knowing that she was married to Gautama Maharishi, Indra cast his evil eyes on her. And one day he came in the form of a bird and started crowing, indicating that it had already been morning. Understanding that it is already dawn, Gautama left to the rivers, and in his absence, this Indra came in the form of Gautama Maharishi and had a physical relationship with her. You know what? Ahalya knew that the person who had come was not her husband. Despite knowing that, she wanted to succumb to the love of Indra because she thought attending to a great king like Indra will help her reach better heights. That is when Gautama came, and he, knowing that Indra had come in the disguise of Gautama, cursed that you will be born of 1,000 eyes, Sahasrakshaha. So you will have 1,000 eyes throughout your body. Then he cursed Ahalya, since you did not have the mercy in you, in your heart, to even be loyal to your husband as much as I am loyal to you, you will turn into a stone. But the word stone was not used. He said, Adrishya Rupena, you will not be visible. So, Adrishya means invisible as well as stone. Why? Because when you see a stone in the road, you don't cast so much of importance to it. Everybody see there is a stone. You never say that. Though you see a stone, it still remains invisible in your inner thoughts. Likewise, he said, Adrishya Bhava. Hey Rama, upon you touching her, she has got emancipation. Correct? Now, what gave emancipation to Ahalya? Who gave emancipation to Ahalya? Rama. What in Rama gave emancipation to Ahalya? Rama's feet. Technically, there is a big problem here. I keep telling in my lectures. Because Tyagaraja tells, I will tell you what Tyagaraja has said. Then we can continue further whether it is right or wrong. Tyagaraja states, Dharini Shilayai Tapamuta Alakavaramukan Nirunuralchaga Shurahalyanu Juchi Brochi Tivi Ariti Dhanyu Seyave Tyagarajage Yama Shri Rama Padamani Kripatsalune Chitani Kirave Shri Rama Padama. The emancipation to Ahalya came from the holy feet of Rama, is what Tyagaraja tells. Overall, it may seem correct. But technically, there is a fault. See, in the normal days, when we sport our footwear, the footwear will be slightly bigger than the size of our foot. If you check your feet now, it will be slightly longer than that. So when Rama would have walked, he would have not known prior that this stone is Ahalya. He would have not taken his foot out of the slipper and kept the foot on it. Had he known that before, he should have not asked his irrelevant question, who is this Ahalya? So that would have not been the case. Second, some people say, no sir, he didn't go with his footwear at all. When he was sent on an exile for 14 years, he was sent on an exile for 14 years itself, he carried his footwear. Kaikeyi let him take his footwear. Now he is coming on an internship with Vishwamitra. So he would have come with his footwear. Second. Third, Rama's foot would have not gotten larger than the slipper, because some of them, they will not buy clothes for their children because they will say, if I keep buying it, they keep growing. So let them wear the tight clothes. So Dasharatha was such an aristocrat that he would have bought a bigger footwear for Rama. So what is the right answer? Vedanta Deshika zooms. He zooms completely into that scene and says, the holy feet of Rama that once gave rise to Ganga had contact with the Paduka. The Padukas of the Lord, when he walked, as with the gait of an elephant, the fine dust that got enveloping the earth flew in the air and fell on the stone, and that stone turned into a lady. So Rama's foot nor his Paduka had any connection with the stone. It is the dust associated with the Paduka that flew and gave emancipation to Ahalya. Namastasmai kasmai chana bhavatu nishkinchana jana swayam raksha diksha swayam adhika samindhana yashase suradhisha swairakshana kupita shapa yudhavadu drishatta durjata prashamana padamboja rajase. So the verse very well indicates in Abhaya Pradana Saram by Vedanta Deshika that it was the dust that gave emancipation to Ahalya. Now further going, Vishwamitra walks further. He narrates the incident of Ahalya and tells, Gautama, come out. Please take Ahalya and accept her. Rama tells, Gautama Maharishi, I am requesting you to accept Ahalya. Why did he do that? Because Rama, before any good event happened to him in his life, he will always ensure that the same good event happens to others before it happens to him. Before Rama could be coronated as the king of Ayodhya, he ensured that Sugriva had Pattabhishekam and Vibhishana had Pattabhishekam, and then he had Pattabhishekam. Even before he could get together with his wife Sita, he ensured that Ahalya and Gautama, the separated couple, come together, and then I will do it. So this further enhanced. Here I have to bring a comparison to another person called Thomas Hardy. If you have heard of this colonial dramatist, he wrote this work called The Tests of the D'Urberville in the 19th century. In The Tests of the D'Urberville, he tells that there was a very, very rich couple in they were the landlords, and they had a son called D'Urberville. And this D'Urberville was an absolute barbaric, uncivilized, ruthless, characterless brat. And in his land, there was a very, very naive and a very, very innocent girl called Tess. And Tess was brought up as the daughter of a very, very poor, destitutional peasants. So this Tess was serving the house of this D'Urberville, and once while the parents were out, D'Urberville goes and rapes and misbehaves with this girl called as Tess. Later, Tess gets married to another normal person. She confesses to her husband that I was once raped by this landlord's son and I had no fault of mine. But that person who believed in the cause of virginity excommunicated his wife from the house. This lady had no resort. When she came to the public and grieved, the public said, it is your mistake of succumbing to the pressure of D'Urberville. It is not D'Urberville's mistake. There D'Urberville had committed mistake. Tess had no fault of hers. Yet the British society put all the fault on this poor girl. Here, Ahalya knew very well that it was Indra who had come in the disguise of her husband. She succumbed to that pressure. Yet Rama tells, forgive her, because it doesn't matter what mistake she has committed in the past, forgive her. So you can decide whether that society was better in forgiving of the tests of the D'Urberville, or it is the Ramayanam that believes in a better concept. Here, going further, we had Rama who was walking behind Vishwamitra. Here comes a beautiful verse of Kamban, who tells, Ivannam nigalndavannam ini inda ulagukkellam uivannam mandri mattor tuyar vannam uruvadundo mai vanna tharakki poril malai vannathu annale un kai vannam angu kanden kaal vannam ingu kanden. Hey Rama, I saw you fighting with all valor with that demoness called Tataka. And now I see you giving emancipation with all compassion to this lady called as Ahalya. There I saw the beauty of your arms. Here I saw the beauty of your feet. This is the literal translation of the Tamil verse. Even mai araki poril malai vannathu annale un kai vannam angu kanden kaal vannam ingu kanden. The word kanden in Tamil is used when you see an object or an event with an element of surprise. General word for seeing in Tamil is parthen, not kanden. If I say copy vaitargal, kanden, that means I have not seen coffee for the last 1 year. So I should use the verse only parthen, not kanden. But he says, kai vannam angu kanden, kaal vannam ingu kanden. I saw the valor of your arms there, I saw the valor of your feet here. So why that element of surprise? Because Vishwamitra thought, if a person has to admonish another person, punish another person, it is always with the foot or the feet. You generally say, let him come here, I will give him a kick. So for punishing, you use your feet. Whereas if you have to encourage the other person, if you have to motivate the other person, you say, come, I'll give you a hug. So for hugging, it's motivation. For feet, it is punishing. Whereas Vishwamitra said, how beautiful Rama is acting corollary and contrary to the world's perception. With the hands that have to motivate, he punishes Tataka. With the feet that have to punish and admonish, he is compassionate to Ahalya. So why will I not be surprised? Kaivannam angu kanden, kaalvannam ingu kanden. The other meaning for it, in Tamil and Sanskrit, there is a beautiful comparison. In Sanskrit, the word padam means feet. The other meaning for padam in Sanskrit is quarter. That is why we say, if some people say, sir, if I go to moksham and they push me down here saying there is no space, what will I do? Vedam tells, tripadasyamritam divi vaikuntham is thrice this lokam, it seems. Tripadam, thrice the quarter. So three-fourths this. So quarter is referred to as padam. Padam is also feet. In Tamil, the word kaal means quarter. Kaal also means feet. So Vishwamitra, in the entire Ramayana, if it were divided into four quarters, Vishwamitra could relish and enjoy the happenings of Ramayana from the birth of Rama till the marriage of Rama to Sita. After that, he is nowhere to be seen. So only a quarter of the portion he is there, three-fourths of the portion he is not there. So he said, I see the beauty of your legs because I am only for a quarter of it. Kaal vannam ingu kandeen. So that kaal is used as a sledai. Sledai means a pun, a word that can be used in two meanings. So with this, they go further. Vedanta Deshika brings the essence of Tatakavadham, Subahu Vadham, Marichas being driven, and Ahalyodharanam in one verse. Jadakirana, Shakaladhara, Jatila, Natapati, Makutatata, Natanapatu, Vibhuda Saridati, Atibahula, Madugalana, Lalitapada, Nalinaraja, Upamritita, Nijabrijina, Jahadupala, Tanurchira, Parama, Munivara, Yuvati Nutta. This one line encapsulates the entire 1 hour lecture that I have done. Now Vishwamitra gets a message stating, Swayamvara, you are invited. Vishwamitra had his own share with his women, Menaka and Ramba. He said, I am no more for this game, but I have got two eligible bachelors with me. He said, let me go to the Swayamvaram. In those days, the woman was given so much of liberty and rights that 10 men were made to stand in front of her and she can garland the person whom she wants. The person who gets garlanded is all happy. Imagine the state of the remaining 9 men. The media will go behind them and check what went wrong for them to get rejected. And beyond the Swayamvaram, there used to be contests in those days. For Rama, it was hitting, using the bow, bending the bow and tying the string. In the case of Mahabharatam, Arjuna had to use the bow, the quiver of arrows, look at the reflection of a fish that was going at the top into the waters and hit at its eye. If they were to give me, I would have happily remained a bachelor. Who will do all these contests and get married to the lady? So in those days, you have to lift a bow to prove your valor. Today, even if we lift a small bucket, we end up with spondylitis. So to get married, if this was the rule of those days that were to be used today, most of the men will have to sit along with Ganapati and keep looking at women, if there are women available, because you will still remain eligible bachelors only. So here, we had the Swayambaram that was happening and Rama entered Mithila. The moment Rama entered Mithila, Janaka spotted the two men, the dark and the fair complexion men, Rama and Lakshmana, and immediately asked, "Hey, Vishwamitra, tell me who these people are." For that he says, "Imau kumarau bhadramte devatulya parakramau gajasimhagati veerau shardula vrishabhopamau padmapatra visalakshau devatulya parikramau." So he tells, gajasimhagati veerau, when I look at these two men, it feels as if the gait of a lion and a rishabham, a bull, a tiger, all were to be seen at one time. Look at their arms, it speaks of their valor. Look at their eyes, it comes to the immaculate beauty that they possess. Look at the way they carry themselves, it says that they are eloquent speakers. Who are these two men? The commentator tells, it seems Janaka did not spot only one son-in-law. He spotted the other. So he spotted the sons-in-law. He wanted both his daughters Sita and Urmila to get married. So he says, "Imau." You remember at the start of the lecture, I said, Dvivachanam is very important. Here it comes. "Imau, Kumarau, Bhadramte, Devatulya Parakramau, Gajasimhagati Veerau, Shardula Vrishabhopamau." See, Sanskrit is one of those unique Indian languages to have singular, dual and plural. Ramaha, Ramau, Ramaha. One Rama, two Ramas, more than three Ramas. Generally, other languages will have singular and plural. Book, books. Pen, pens. Pencil, pencils. But in Sanskritam, it is one pencil, two pencils, more than three pencils. You will be surprised to know one of the international languages that is to have the same principle of single, dual, plural in the ancient form is German. Because Germans believe that their language is derived from Sanskrit. So the grammatical rules are also very, very similar. So here, getting back to, by digressing most of my times itself, I'm losing my time. Here, they entered Mithila. So as they entered Mithila, Vishwamitra said, "I will walk by the main road. Rama, you are free to go anywhere you want." So Rama walked by the by streets of Mithila. Mithila cross street, Mithila main road, Mithila. So he walked by that Mithila cross street. He was the only one in that cross street. There was a low hanging balcony called the gazebo. In that gazebo, alongside the gazebo, there were a few girls who were playing. There Sita was playing with her friends. There she was playing the ball of flowers. While the ball fell on the other side, the girl said, "Sita, go pick that up." And Sita came running. As Sita came running to pick the ball, she looked down. She was amazed to see that this street is generally uninhabited. Who is the person who could be traveling or be the passer by the street? At that point in time, Rama thought, somebody is looking at me, and he looked at the top. But both of them were oblivious that the Tamil poet Kamban was looking at them. He says, "Yennarum nalathinaal inaiyal ninrozhi kannodu kanninai kavvi onrai onru unnavum nilai peraadu unarvu onrida annarum nokinan avalum nokinal vas marungila nangayum vasayillaiyanum orungiya irandu udarku uyir endru gaayinar karungadal palliyil kalavi neengi poi பிரிந்தவர் கூடினால் பேசல் வேண்டுமோ." If you are a person who relishes languages without any political leanings, you will appreciate the poetry what Kamban has come up with. He tells, "Annarum nokinan Avalum nokinal. She too saw, he too saw. Grammatically, this is a big mistake. You can use too only once. You can say he came, she came, and that man too came. You'll never say he too came, she too came, that man too came. So, annarum nokinan, avalum nokinal is grammatically wrong. But why is two ums used? Because when it is not an incident but an accident, you can use that. See, we go in the main road. Suppose we find that one cab was hitting the other cab on the other side of the road. We being inquisitive Indians, we'll always ask, sir, what happened? The other person who has never been a party to this accident will come and explain to us as if he has seen it like Rahasyam cha, Prakasham cha, like Valmiki. He will come and say, sir, this person was coming on the left side. That person came in the right. No, sir, if both are coming in the right direction, how did this happen? Finally, he will have no resort but to say, sir, avunu banda, ivunu banda. So when it is an accident, you won't have any other course. You will exceed the grammatical rule. You will say, he too came, she too came. Avanu vanna, ivanu vanna. So when it is an accident and not an incident, had Rama said, come at 8:30 to that place, let us meet over a cup of coffee, a lot more can happen over a cup of coffee, then it is an incident. You cannot use two twos. Here they did not know that they will be seeing each other. So annarum nokinan, avalum nokinal was an accident. The second meaning to it, which is very, very important. In many houses where the concept of arranged marriage still remotely exists, in such houses, the parents will end up seeing the Jatakam first. So they'll see Guru is looking at whom, Ketu is not looking at whom, Rahu and Ketu, what are they busily doing? So they will look at their horoscope. The family's chemistry will match. These parents will like the other set of parents. So they will feel education-wise also everything has come to the right wavelength. Everything matches. They will even fix up the Kalyana Mantapam. But the only thing is, Rahu is not seeing Guru properly. So what to do in that case? They will get very upset. Sir, Jatakam is not matching. I went to my astrologer. He said you have to do this Pariharam. You have to go to the middle of the Western Ghats to one particular temple in the middle of the night. I light this lamp and come. Either they will tell or say, they'll say don't carry on this marriage. So what to do? I will give you an easy solution. This is an authenticated solution from Shastram. Apastamba Maharishi tells in his Sutram, if everything matches except the horoscope, then bring the prospect bride and the prospect groom together. Bring the eldest of the family and ask them to watch quietly. If the prospect girl and the prospect boy communicate through their eye gestures, then you don't have to touch their jatakam, carry on with the marriage. This is the sutram in Apastamba. Ikshanatve is the name of that sutram. I don't know how many astrologers, because if astrologers tell this, then they will lose their business. They'll say, annarum nokinal, avalum nokinal happened, sir, then we will leave it. But as per Shastram, if the eyes meet, because you know which is the biggest communicator in our body? The eyes. Not even the mouth. Especially as somebody came and asked, sir, you're telling like this, what about in China? That I cannot help. In our country, eyes are the best communicators. How do we know? In a lecture, when I turn, see, I am not Brahma. I've got only one head. So if I look at this side, the other side, some may plan to leave. So how will they leave? They will not openly say. They'll say. But I should act as if I'm not looking at them. That is the art that a speaker holds. So, eyes become the biggest communicator, right? So, even if a mother takes the child to some party, she'll say, come. So, see, the eyes become such big communicators. So, ikshanatve is a sutram in Apastamba. You go ask your astrologer. First of all, astrologers don't come after reading Shastram. That is the saddest part of the day. So, when Kamban tells annarum nokinan, avalum nokinal, he implies that when their eyes have met, you don't have to look at their horoscope. Pirindavar kudinal peshal vendumo. When two people who have been separated for a very long time come together, it seems they don't have to get ecstatic and scholastic about communicating. Even their eyes are enough to communicate that I'm seeing you after a long time. That is the beauty of love. So they met. Now Rama goes to the main Vatika where the bow has been kept. It is a Shiva Dhanus. Lord Shiva and Vishnu supposedly had one quarrel, and Vishnu did the Panchajanya Nadam, and with that there happened an air crack in Shiva's bow. Shiva said war discontinued, and he gave this bow to Ikshvaku Vamsham, and that Vamsham had that bow. Whoever strings this bow, because to lift a bow is the first challenge. Second, you have to string it, because the stronger the string, the longer will your arrow go. This is Dhanurvidya. So whoever does that will be the prospect groom for my daughter. This is what Janaka said. So all of them had gathered. Every other king tried, they failed. Now Vishwamitra tells, Vatsa Rama Dhanuf Pashya Iti Raghavam Abravit. This is the sentence in Valmiki Ramayanam. Commentator comments for 10 pages. Vatsa, he tells, my dear child, amongst Rama and Lakshmana, who is the child? Lakshmana, because he was born 2 days after Rama, right? So Vatsa, the moment Vishwamitra said this, Lakshmana got up. Vishwamitra thought, now Ramayana is going to take a major diversion, detour. He said, Vatsa Rama. Then Lakshmana sat and Rama got up. Dhanuf Pashya. Look at the bow. You tell your child, look at the bow. The child will look at the bow and come out. I looked at the bow and came. What did Vishwamitra mean? He said, you go to the bow, lift it, handle it, string it and come. But he never said Dhanuhu Aropya. He never said lift. He said Dhanuf Pashya. Why? Because Vishwamitra was very vigilant. Dasharatha had sent the apple of his eye, who is Rama, along with him. And if Rama has been asked to lift the bow, then Rama will go and complain to his father, this old man whom you sent me with is asking me to lift the bow. Then he will be behind bars. So he said, Vatsa Rama Dhanuf Pashya. You go and see. Because Kosalaha Saha Ingitagnyaha, people of the Kosala province were adept in understanding eye gestures. They could understand. You know how Vishwamitra said, Vatsa Rama Dhanuhu Pashya. The word is Pashya, but still his eye gesture is lifting. So Dhanuf Pashya, Vatsa Rama Dhanuf Pashya. Why he just said Pashya? Because Rama was so adept enough in understanding that word Pashya. Dhanuf Pashya Iti Raghavam Abravit. So Rama walked towards the bow and lifted the bow. When he lifted the bow and tied the string to it, the bow broke. Then others said, you will not get Sita. Now you have caused damage to the bow. Janaka said, I will get it repaired in the workshop. I am very happy that my daughter is getting finally married. Because all these days he was hunting with this contest, who can lift the bow? None could lift it. Finally he found one person. That itself was a blessing in disguise. So now Sita was looking at Rama. Being a lady of adept with shyness, she could not look at him directly. All the women were surrounding her. So she had to look at Rama, how he lifted the bow. But she could not reveal this to others, and it had to act with that iota of shyness in her. So Tyagaraja tells, it seems she was wearing loose bangles in her hand. So she let it loose. She acted as if the bangles were about to fall. So all the other women, their attention were on her bangles, whether they would fall. And at that instant, with her corner glances, she saw Rama, it seems. Kala kala manu mukha palu galigina sita kulu kuchu ora gannula nuju che ninnu kana kana ruchira kana kavasana ninu kala kala manu mukha palu galigin sita kulu kuchu oragannulanu juche ninnu. Tyagaraja tells, the other women might have not spotted you, Mata, but I have seen you. Sitam mayam shri ramudu makutalji sitam mayamma vatatmaja saumitri vairateya ripumadana. Janaka was super happy. He said, Sita immediately carry that garland and garland him. Rama said, Pitrubihi, without my father's permission, in this janmam I will not marry. What does that imply? In the next janmam, Krishna avataram, none of my marriages will be approved by my parents. So he said very carefully, Pitribihi yam janma, in this janmam I will not do so. So immediately a letter was sent to Dasharatha. Dasharatha came with the entire cavalry. He was super happy. He didn't have to register to bharatmatrimony.com and say 5-6 wheat complexion, ragi complexion, clean habits, vegetarian and all this. So his son has found someone, thank God, he's relieving me of all the other duties, and they all came. Ratha gaja turaga padadi. Incidentally, the Tamil poet states the clusters in which they came. Whenever you find a very populated, densely populated army approaching, in Tamil you say yellu potta yellu vidadu. That means if you throw up a handful of sesame onto the air, they will not fall on earth because they will end up falling on the heads of the people. It is so thickly populated. But you know what Kamban says? Ulundu potta ulundu vidam kootam. He says if you take ulundu urad dal and put it, it will not fall. Why didn't he use the word sesame and he used urad? Because sesame seed is generally used for tarpanam and devasam, whereas they are going for a marriage, so urad only has to be used. So the poet says, ulundu potta ulundu vida kootam. So as they get inside the assembly, all of them, then Janaka tells, I have got a younger brother who has got two daughters, Mandavi and Shrutakirti. Dasharatha, I understand you've got two more sons. Let us be economically very, very strict. Cost cutting. All four of them, let them get married in one pandal. Rama to Sita, Urmila to Lakshmana, Mandavi to Bharata, Shrutakirti to Shatrughna. Let us get that done. Vasishtha said, no problem for me, but the only thing is you have to pay 4 times the fees. You should not reduce the fees for me because I have to do the marriage ritual separately for each one of them. Vasishtha was married. Arundhati would have told him that way. Now, as they reach the Yajnavatika, Janaka comes in front and he says, now let me do the Panigrahanam. See, there are many rituals in a typical Brahma Vivaham. Brahma Vivaham is not Brahmana Vivaham. Brahma Vivaham is the Vedic customed Vivaham. So, I will not be explaining all the rituals. One or two I will explain. In that, they read the Kalyana Patrika. This is a very important ritual which we do in discourses. I will read out the Vivaha Mahotsava Patrika of Rama and Sita. You can listen to it. It is a Churnika. Atha Janaka Nripati Manorata Mahannava Parangatva Paramananda Jaladhauni Magnaha Jagat Chakshuhu Kulabhushanasya Jagatraya Samrakshana Dikshitasya Natha Janakalpataroho Shriko Danda Diksha Guroho Vivaha Mahotsava Kshitirata Varapurita Manorata Bhagirata Vamsha Jatam Matirata Maharata Prithivi Padivanditam Dasharata Maharajam Ratha Gaja Turaga Padadi Sahitam Samantri Purohitam Saputra Kalatram Saparivaramanaya Satkritanana Vidakramukanari Kedarambadi Palagucha Sahasrashata Kumbastamba Bhushite Jambhari Chirakangshite Paripurna Manorata Parapramoda Paura Bhakta Jana Paraspara Kridasallape Sakala Manohara Lape Kirita Kavaja Kundala Keyura Nupura Muktahara Vibhushita Nana Vida Mrudula Chitra Sanastanana Deshagada Raja Varya Brinde Lochana Nande Nana Vida Varna Swarna Pushpastabaka Koti De Dipyamalaya Chandana Guru Guggulu Gogruta Divya Marimala Vasana Vastu Gumugumayamana Sabhantare Nirantara Manikajita Mukura Parampare Beri Mridanga Maddala Kahala Tunduvi Turiya Tumburu Veena Venu Nupura Madduka Dindima Damaruka Janjari Jallari Dhavala Shanka Panava Ashtadasha Vadya Gosha Santada Shabda Yamana Segala Digantare Narada Tumburu Veena Gana Manohare Savatsa Gosahasradhyaneka Koti Hiranya Vastra Bharana Bhudana Bahumana Santoshita Patra Bhutobaya Sambandhi Raja Seshta Vamshavali Nama Gotra Paravaro Charani Punavasishta Vamadeva Vishwamitra Shatanandadi Sakala Munigana Sankirana Vivaha Vedi Madhye Kritastava Siddha Sadhye Abjabhava Jishnumukha Hrishta Sakala Tridasha Saptavatu Ashtavashu Yakshagana Siddhajana Rudragana Satkrita Pavitrata Mitrakula Ratna Sagunastava Samasta Prashasta Virudastoma Ninade Nirasta Ghanadendra Virude Sankarshana Dhyamara Brindava Kiryamana Mandara Kusumaukanandana Varshe Navaratna Manikachita Kanakamaya Mantape Kinchita Rabdhata Arunyam Natajanaika Karunyam Vidalita Mahesha Chapam Vidimuka Sura Vidida Pratapam Parikrita Munijana Tapam Bhanukula Ratna Deepam Sampurita Bhakta Janakamam Sakam Sakala Jaladhara Shyamam Sakala Loka Abhiramam Shri Ramam. This is Rama's side. They have read the Patrika. Now let us go to Sita. Sannivesh Ketaki Champaka Mallika Dyalankrita Neelalaka Venim Kalahamsa Gaminim Karunavalokinim Anakamanika Chita Hemakantim Swarajandakara Kantim Hataka Manimaya Tataka Alankrita Kapolam Aganita Kalyana Gunashilam Aravinda Sundara Mandahasa Mukim Shri Raghunandanabha Mukim Kritva Iyam Sita Mamasuta Sahadharma Charitava Praticha Chainam Bhadram Te Panim Grinhishva Panina Pativrata Mahabhaga Chaye Vanugata Sada Iti Kshirabdhiriva Mahalakshmim Srimate Narayanaya Shobhana Mantrakshata Hiranyodaka Dhara Sahitam Mandasmitam Sitam Shri Ramachandra Kararavinde Samarpayama Sashubham. This is the marriage invitation of what was read for Rama and Sita. We have something called as Panigrahanam. Iyam Sita, Mamasuta, Sahadharma Charitava, Praticha Chainam Bhadramte, Panim Grinihishva Panina. A beautiful shloka with very, very intricate meanings. Here we have Janaka who tells Rama, Rama, you're very handsome. Chandrakantananam Ramam Ativav Priyadarshanam Rupa Audarya Gunaihi Pumsam Drishtichitta Paharinam. Rama, you will take away the minds and the eyes of the people with the qualities that you possess and the beauty that you carry. By saying this, Rama said, yes, I am handsome. People have said that, but he said, Janaka said, yes, you are handsome. Iyam Sita. Now look at my daughter. Iyam Sita. Rama, you know very well that gold comes from this earth. You know, right? Yes, he said. When gold comes from earth, my daughter has also emerged from earth. Hiranya Varnam Harinim. She has also come from earth. Yam Sita, look at my daughter. Rama said, you keep talking about the beauty of your lot. Whereas for me, when people say I am very valorous as well as beauty, why are you not talking about other qualifications? Janaka said, I am very sure, Rama, that you have valor and beauty. And my daughter has beauty. You are worried why I am not talking about other qualities. See, for objects that have very little value, you need to exhibit a lot of qualities and make them sell. My daughter is like a diamond. In case if she is a diamond, I just have to tell you the value. I don't have to talk about. See, to sell a 10 rupees steel box, they will tell you. This is stainless steel. Very good box, very good cutting, very good circular shape. This was used in the earlier days. So for one 10 rupees steel box, he will give you 10 salient features. If you go to a diamond shop, he will just show you a diamond. He will not explain that diamond. But that doesn't mean that diamond is anywhere less priced than the stainless steel box. To sell Rama, you need two attributes. Whereas to give my daughter, I need only one attribute. So she is better than you, Yam Sita. The other thing he tells, Mama Sutta, she is my daughter. Yesterday when Dasharatha said, May Rama, he wanted to put Vishwamitra in the wrong shoes, telling that I have added Mamakaram to the object, so you cannot take it. But today Janaka tells, I am very well aware when I am telling that she is my daughter. Why? Because there is an anecdote about Janaka. Janaka had his court under the guidance of a rishi called Yajnavalkya. Yajnavalkya had many students, amongst whom one was Janaka. But in the class, only Janaka was attentive and the other students were not. So Yajnavalkya would look only at Janaka and teach. The other students were jealous. So to teach them a lesson, what Yajnavalkya did was, he caught up a illusionary fire in Mithila. When Mithila was burning, these people started running hither and thither. They said, where are my objects? I need to protect my objects. Immediately, Yajnavalkya asked Janaka, Janaka, others are running to protect their objects. Can you go and protect your object? Janaka said, Pradiptayam Mithilayam Name Kinchit Pradahyate. Burning is the city of Mithila. There is nothing in the city which is mine. There is nothing that I hold as mine. So he, Janaka, was bereft of Mamakaram. So he was famous in this world for not attaching Mamakaram to the object. But that Janaka today tells Mamasuta, because Sita was such a beautiful girl with such good qualities that she even coaxed a king like Janaka, who was bereft of Mamakaram, to say that she is my daughter. Mamasuta. In certain parties, parents go with their children, and the children, if they are notorious and somebody asks whose child it is, the mother will say, I don't know whose child. Because she doesn't want that Mamakaram to get attached there. Whereas he tells, Iyam Sita Mamasuta Sahadharma Charitava. She is your better half. I keep telling this in every lecture of mine. The wife is called the better half, not the husband. Why so? Because in Lakshmi Ashtotram, the Rishi tells, Paramatmikayai Namaha. Why can you, in half, suppose you divide 1 into 0.5 and 0.5, 0.5 is equal to 0.5. There is nothing better out of it. But the wife is still called the better half. How can you call the half as better? Because my Acharya used to state, there's an anecdote to it. While I was in BITS in my second year, where I thought it was futile to read thermodynamics anymore, then we thought we can dwell into Lakshmi Ashtotram. And that is when we understood the secret of it. See, 0.48, the decimal, can be approximated to 0.5. 0.52 can also be approximated to 0.5. 0.5 and 0.5 may seem the same, but 0.48 is not equal to 0.52. There is still a difference of 0.04. So, 0.52 has reached 0.5. 0.48 has reached 0.5. Though they may seem equal, this half is the better half because it has come from 0.52. So, Mahalakshmi carries certain qualities, so does Vishnu. They may seem equal, but she carries mercy in larger proportion, so she is 0.52 to 0.5, whereas he loses mercy, so he is 0.48 to 0.5, so she is the better half. So this better half concept comes in the word Sahadharma Charitava. She is the better half. Praticha, he tells, hold my hand, girl's hand, palm really well. Praticha. Chainam Bhadram Te. Only if you hold her well. Don't hold her in such a way as if your father held. Because when Dasharatha, when Vishwamitra introduces Rama to Janaka, you know what he tells? Janaka, this is Dasharatha's son Rama. But he is the namesake son of Dasharatha. You know who nurtured him? It is Vasishta. Will you end up introducing the prospect son-in-law like this? Sir, he is the son-in-law, Mr. Suresh. That is his father. He's just a namesake father, sir. His father is somebody else. Will you ever say that? He tells, the namesake father is Dasharatha, but the real father is Vasishta. Why? Because Dasharatha was notorious for marrying 350 women. Now if the prospect father-in-law gets to know that he's Dasharatha's son, he will never give his daughter. So he says, he's a namesake son of Dasharatha, but nurtured by Vasishta, who's a ekapatni vrata. So you can easily give because he will carry the attributes of the person who has nurtured him. So here Rama, Janaka tells, Sahadharma Charitava, she will be your better half. If you walk on the path of Dharma Rama, she will walk along with you. If you walk astray, if you go astray, then she will make you walk in the path of Dharmam. Sahadharma Charitava Praticha. Hold her palm in such a way that you do not leave her at one instant and tell she has gone, so I will marry somebody else. You should hold her in such a way that without her you cannot survive even for a minute. Praticha Chainam Bhadramte Panim Grinhishva Panina Pativrata. Hold her hand, palm in such a way. Hastam. This is called Hastam or Pani. Pani Grahanam means holding the palm. Pani is called hastam. Bandhanam is holding. So, pani grahanam is called hasta bandhanam. Take the has and the band out of it, you will get husband. Hasta bandhanam. So, we could have had words because most of the words in English that we use today don't come from English itself. They derive their roots from Latin, French. For example, if you take entrepreneur, entre will be a French word. Preneur will be another Latin word. Two words together will come with an English word. So, the words that we misconceive as English words could be derived from other foreign languages. I'm sure this will be one of those words. Hastabandhanam. So, you hold my daughter in hand. Pativrata, Mahabhaga, Chayevanugata Sata. So, this was what Janaka told and Rama held Sita's hand. And this was an incident that happened in Treta Yugam. But in Kali Yugam, there existed a great Rama Bhakta called Thyagaraja in a kshetram called as Panchanadi Kshetram, which is called Tiruvayyaru in Tamil Nadu. He was a poor scholar, but a learned scholar. Why are you putting both together? Because in those days, there used to be a saying in Sanskrit. That is, a person from Kanauj visited a learned scholar's house. The learned scholar's house was in shambles. It was in a deteriorated, dilapidated situation. So he asks, you are learned, why is your situation so destitution? Why are you in poverty? So this person said, Lakshmi refused to come to my house. Why does Lakshmi have any vengeance against learned people? Because Lakshmi once said, it seems, learned people like you only cause distress to me. Once a learned person called Agastya drank the oceanic waters given giving me no place in my father's house. Next came this rishi called Atri, who plucked lotuses from the pond and offered to the Lord, thereby taking my seat of sitting called as lotus. And third came Bhrigu, who offered me to the Lord himself, and he kicked at my Lord's chest where I was residing. So I decided from that day I will not stay in learned person's house. So in those days, if you have to describe a learned person, you will add a prefix to it, a poor learned person, you would say. So here the poor learned person who was Tyagaraja brings out the essence of Ramayanam in thousands of kritis in a beautiful language called Telugu. Because the Tamil poet Bharatiyar tells, Sundara Telanginil Pattisaitu. He tells that if you have to compose songs, you have to compose in a language like Telugu, which is so beautiful. If you talk of Kannada, they say it is Kasturi Kannada. So every language is so beautiful. The only thing is we should have the open mentality to learn. Adu barallari. Idu agala, idu varadu, adu varadu. If you keep telling, then it is very, very tough to grasp a language. As human beings, we are endowed to be polyglots. The only thing is we are not using that opportunity. We feel, we start poking fun at the other language. That is the worst thing that we can ever do. We start poking fun at either Tamil. If I am a Kannadiga, I start poking fun at Telugu. If I am a Telugu person, I start poking fun at Hindi. So this should not be the mentality if we have to learn languages. We should start appreciating every other's language. This is the essence. I am sure a lot of you will know that there are concerts that happen in the Chennai music season during Margadi. Over 4,000 concerts will happen simultaneously by various artists. And in most of the concerts, you will have Telugu kritis, Kannada Devaranamas, Tamil Kirtanas, Hindi Bhajan, Abhang. In most of the states, if you cross, you will never find any artist singing a Tamil Kirtana. Because they'll say either Tamil is tough. They will not sing any other language. If you go to the north, they may not even know the difference between the four South Indian languages. The only word is Madrasi. For us, for every language, Gujarati, Marathi, everything is Hindi. So that should not be the case. Going forward, we should start appreciating every other's language. Here we had Tyagaraja, who beautifully describes. He says, I want to celebrate the marriage of Rama with Sita, but where will I hire a hall like Purandara Bhavana, and where can I do it? He said, my heart is the mantapam. The arteries and the pulmonary vein and the aorta that runs in it are the toranams. The blood that goes in between adds the air in it. And I will construct a beautiful swing for my beautiful couple who's my mother and my father, Rama and Sita. So he constructed one in the bottomest of his heart and let that swing. But then he thought, I am after all a primitive mortal who's trying to attain the supreme personal. I am not adept enough to even swing the swing of the couple. So he goes back out of Naichanusandhanam. He hits upon the shoulder of another great devotee who is Hanuman. Hanuman tells, sir, if you yourself withdraw yourself that you are unfit, even I am unfit. So they start quarreling amongst each other, who is better amongst them to swing. Finally, Hanuman tells, let us both swing, sir. Only if Tyagaraja comes will I do. And they start swinging. And this swinging procedure created the best of the compositions the world has ever seen in emotion. Pavana jastuti patra pavana charitra ravi soma varanetra ramaniya gatra sita kalyana vaibhoga kalyana vaibhogame bhakta jana paripala bharita sharajala bhukti mukti dalila bhudeva pala par Pamara Sura Bhima Paripurna Kama Shyama Jagada Bhirama Saketa Dhama Sarvaloka Dhara
samarai kavira garvamanavadura kanakagadhira nigamagamavihara nirupamasharira nagadharagavidara nadalokadhara parameshanutagita bhavajaladhipota dharanikulasanjata tyagarajanuta sita kalya na vaibhogame rama kalyana vaibhogame.
Parashara Maharishi in Vishnu Puranam tells Maitreya, even 1,000 years will not be enough, Maitreya, to describe this beautiful marriage between Rama and Sita. If a great Maharishi like Parashara says even 1,000 years is not enough, will it be enough for 2 hours for a primitive mortal like me? Sita's marriage to Rama in Ramayanam of Valmiki has to be experienced and internalized. How much ever you listen to it, it may not be of much use. As long as you start developing a canvas in front of you, that beautiful toranam, the people standing on either sides, and the sounds and the Vedic sounds that come should add richness to it. And that is the essence of Sanatana Dharma, which gives us the liberty to imagine, portray and relish it the way we want. With this beautiful religion that has given us this matchless, peerless and priceless scripture, here I need to sign off for today of Balakandam. Thus we have witnessed Balakandam June 15th, 16th, 17th. Mark your calendars, mark it today itself. Same timings we will have Ayodhya Kandam with Paduka Patta Abhishekam, followed by November 16th and 17th, Friday and Saturday here. November 18th, we are going to have a big dance production telling the Bala, Ayodhya and Aranyakanda. So those of you who have come, when you come see the dance, you will be able to relive your experience. That is going to happen. November 18th program dance will be happening at a different location, which is MLR Convention Center, Whitefield. Advertisements will come in Times of India, where you have to buy your tickets in some of the online sites. I wish a lot of you can bring a lot of your children also to that visual event, so that they get to witness that spiritual as well as a classical extravaganza. With this, I would also like to tell that a beautiful book called Vedanta Deshika, the peerless poet preceptor on Vedanta Deshika, one of the greatest acharyas the world has ever seen, commemorating his 750th birth anniversary. We had the opportunity to release the book where I have authored the book. The illustrations are by the famed cartoonist of the Hindu newspaper R. Keshav, photographs by R. Vinod. It entails the life and works of Vedanta Deshika and various facets of him being a consummate dramatist. There's a prosopography that is also done with it, with his life characteristics as a dietitian and testimonials from sagacious preceptors. So I would request all of you to buy the book. Cash is accepted as well as Paytm. So those of you who wish to buy can buy. And one more kind announcement. Yesterday I did speak about my app. It is called Desika Daya. D-E-S-I-K-A, D-A-Y-A. Two different words. Desika Daya. As of now, it is available only for Android users and not the iOS users. That will be made available a month later. For Android users, you have to go to the Play Store, type Desika Daya, download the app and register. Is the registration costing you anything? Not even a paise. You have to put your first name, last name, date of birth, acharya's name, whoever is your acharya, or your qualification, your profession, and your address, and then you have to register. You will get the activation code either on your mobile as an SMS or on your mailbox, registered mail ID. In that mail, you need to go and check in your inbox or all mail or spam. You can check the activation code. It will be a 4-digit code. Put that code here. And once you put that code, you're registered forever. You will get to hear 1,000 hours of Tamil and English lectures for free. You just have to go there. It is arranged topic-wise. Vishnu Puranam, Bhagavatam, Ramayanam, Chatushloki, Munivahana Bhogam, Sankalpa Suryodayam, Yakshav Prashnam, Mahabharatam, Narayaniyam, Tirupavai. Then you have got Upanyasam Silos, Garuda Vaibhavam, Varaha Charmashlokam, Krishna Charmashlokam. There are close to 1,000 hours of lectures on various topics. You just have to register and listen. So, suppose you don't understand Tamil. There are a few English lectures. More English lectures will get added to it. There is one more kind announcement. In the month of April, we are doing a second yatra to Sri Lanka. That is, we are going to take 80 people to Sri Lanka, showing them places related to Ramayana. It is called Ramayana in Lanka. So you all have to come to Chennai. And from Chennai, we will fly you to Lanka. It will be a 7-day, 6-night tour, where we will be staying in Sigiriya, one night in Kandy, 2 nights in Nuvara Iliya, 1 night in Colombo, and so on. So food will be Sattvic food, prepared by cooks who will be ferried from here. You will get Sattvic food. You will get to hear lectures on Narayaniyam every day. And we will be taking you to places. The flight and the visa will be arranging. For those of you who wish to contact, there were a few pamphlets yesterday. I will, if they are not available, I'll tell you the email ID. That is one. Second, in the month of September, 5 days, we are taking devotees to Muktinath, which is Salagramam. So from Delhi, we will be flying you to Kathmandu. Kathmandu, we will be flying you to Pokhara. Pokhara to Jumsum upon climatic conditions. Then Jumsum, you will be going by jeep, and then you will be going by a pony, and then you will be walking. It's a very, very adventurous, yet a very nice exercise. Kalayum, Kariyum, Parimavum, Thiriyum Kanam, Kadanduboy, Shilayum, Kanayum, Tunayaga, Shendran Vendri, Shirukkalat, Malagund, Alami, Danekati, Malinir Kundu, Val, Arakar, Talaipat, Arutuhandan, Shalakiramam, Adai Ninje, tells Alvar. It's a beautiful place on the banks of River Kentucky, 13,500 feet high, one of the 108 Divyadeshams. So, 5 days. Those of you who wish to contact can also contact. That is the yatra we will be taking. So the yatra mail ID is yatrabybai. I will be repeating it thrice. Yet after that somebody will come and ask me. So note it down. Yatra yatra by by. B for boy, y for yak. By yatra by. DS. D stands for Dushyant. S stands for Sridhar. DS. BB, B for boy, B for boy at gmail.com. Yatra by DSBB at gmail.com. DS, D is first Dushyant. BB is for B for boy, B for boy. All small letters, no full stop, no special characters. If you download the app, you can book for the yatra clicking that inquiries also. Okay, that is another way to do it. So those of you who wish to buy the book, it is always there. I would request all of you to kindly come for the lectures in the month of June and November. Some of you had volunteered stating that we can take some of the posters, sir, next time, and we will put up in our apartment society. Those of you who share that healthy relationship in your living society and your gated community or your place of work, may kindly give your names to Subhash, who's seated in the first row, or to Priya, or to any of the volunteers, stating that send one copy of the brochure to me. We will put it in our apartment association. This is a free event, so I don't think anybody will object to it. As of now, our society is also a God-believing society, so they will not have a problem. So you can spread the word and bring a lot of the college-going youngsters here. I'm sure I'm not going to disappoint them with too much of irrational thoughts and explanations that I'll give. With this, I would like to conclude. Kavitarkika Simhaya Kalyana Gunashalini Srimate Venkateshaya Veda Pavamana Sutudu Pattu Padara Vindamulaku Ninama Rupamulaku Nityajaya Mangalam Rajiva Nayana Tyaga Rajadi Vinutamaina Ninama Rupamulaku Nityajaya Mangalam.